looking at second, or are we looking at second and third?
I think we'd have to do them separately, yeah, since they're separate document. So has everybody had enough time to look at October 2nd? Any changes, corrections to the October 2nd minutes?
As you know, throughout the day, we cross-reference the Massachusetts 2000 standards with the Common Core State standards, the correlating standards, correlating grade levels, and I see no mention of that. I have looked ahead, and I do see it at the beginning of the next day, which we also started there, but there was a lot of discussion on October 2nd. I mean, the two documents, we started with one, but we brought in the other one throughout the day.
And I took notes on all of those things that we were supposed to do.
Correct. And I've also reread Jay's notes that are in our Dropbox. And he has even included some of the codes so that you know it was either the Massachusetts code or the Common Core code. You could tell
which document
was being referred to.
So what would you like it to change to reflect?
I think if you, if on three and four, where you refer to Massachusetts, you just say reviewed and compared the Massachusetts 2000 math standards for 5th and 6th grade with Common Core. I mean, that's what we did. We just went back and forth.
Yeah, we kept I don't care. So whatever language the group would like to put in there.
So what would you like to say?
I'll suggest, I mean, I'll be able to make a motion, but review the Massachusetts 2000 math standard for 5th and 6th grade in comparison to Common Core, CCSS, similar standards in CCSS. You can't really say 5th and 6th grade there necessarily.
Okay, so
comparison to similar CCSS standards. Because I think that's what we did all the time.
We kept them both out and went back and forth. Yeah, you're probably right. So
and the same thing on number three, and the same thing on number four.
So how we word it for three, it would be the same as the wording for four. It would just
and compared to similar CCSS standards.
Okay, so anybody has some suggestive wording? I think I understand what Bob is saying, but probably we need to put it there because if somebody's not here, to make it really clear. Hi, Fred. Come on down.
By the way, I'd like to introduce Beverly. I don't really know Beverly other than she emailed me for some information. This is Beverly Meyer. She's representing the higher ed, and this is her first meeting with us.
Woohoo!
You want to know who we are, or do you want to take a test?
Well, I can read pretty far.
Okay.
So I'll probably save the time if I just come around and stay with you.
So any suggestion on the wording of three?
How about review of two, and don't, please don't put this down.
No,
review of two documents for 5th and 6th grade, : Massachusetts 2000 math standards, Common Core State Standards for Mathematics.
Okay.
I just want to tell them that we took two documents and we compared the standards.
Okay.
And list the documents.
Okay, so two documents, or should we say for grades 5 through 6, and then we can say review two documents for 7 and 8 when we get down to that. So
sounds good.
Sure.
So review two documents for grades 5 and 6, Massachusetts 2000 and Common Core. Does that sound all right? And then to do exactly the same thing for 4, review two documents. Massachusetts 2000 and Common Core for 7th and 8th grade. Is that the language you want to use? Okay, so is there a motion that we make that change or any.
Do you want to add other changes, or do you want to act on them one by one?
It doesn't make any difference. I guess, should we put it all together?
Put it all together.
Okay, so Amy, you have the wording for that?
Right.
Okay. Any others?
I just have a concern.
Go ahead. You said review of two documents for grades 5 and 6. Do you want to put mathematics in there somewhere?
That would be a good thing.
That's a really good point.
Okay. So review, and then we'll have you read it before we vote. So that would be correct. Okay, Nancy, what else?
And just for clarification, CCSSM inherently says mathematics. That's what Pam
says. Yes, the CCSM. And so we can say the mathematics, Massachusetts Mathematics Documents 2000 and CCSM.
Okay, so put it in that part of this.
Wherever you want.
Yeah, that's what we'll have you read it back.
Before we do it.
We'll have you read it back.
Okay.
I need some clarification because we said that these are minutes of our meetings, and there are things in here put as action items that I don't know that we agreed to as groups that were necessarily action items. It seems like it's just an interpretation of who's taking the minutes. Normally, minutes to me, action items are things that we vote on and that we say that we're going to take an action on. I don't care that they're listed here, but I hope that we truly agree that they're action items. Some of them, because someone has to act on them then.
Right.
And I have acted on, I don't know if anyone else has acted, but I've done an awful lot of acting for the group, and I don't mind doing it. But I think that we should agree as a group that it is truly an action item. I don't think that we necessarily agreed that, and I have, the only one that I didn't have from this first one completed by the time we met on the 3rd, I believe, was the science group. And I have tried to ask who I should contact, and I haven't gotten a clear answer on that from someone in charge. And so I want to make sure that we're saying these are action items. I don't think that we, I think we took something out that said something about we should go ask someone else something, but I don't think that that was our intent when we were sitting there. So just because we ponder something, I don't believe it's an action item. So I kind of like those things clarified before we put in the minutes.
That's kind of the point of you put out the draft and you have everybody agree. Is that what we agree? Why do? We should have a record of what you all discussed and agreed doing. We didn't do any of that by motion, so you can't say a motion was made to go contact K5. But otherwise, things that everybody agreed that we should do get lost.
But I don't think everyone agreed to all that, is my point.
Yeah, we probably should. If we're going to have an action item, we probably should. I think that would be a wise thing to do.
Yeah, I think that what would also come out in the minutes is who that action is assigned to. Yeah.
Right.
That's a problem that we didn't assign it to anybody.
Well, and so if we do an action, if we decide upon doing an action statement, then who's going to be the responsible party to take care of that?
Yeah.
Because it shouldn't be Nancy doing it all the time. It should be.
But I mean, there are a lot of things we said, we seem to agree to in terms of, we like this and this standard. None of those are listed in here either. So
right. We
probably should make a distinction in our minutes that an action, anything that's going to be reported as an action is a motion. I think that makes it that way we all know we agreed on it and that was a suggestion that I agreed down to is that if we say we're going to do something, we probably should vote on it that way.
And who's the responsible party for doing that?
That's just part of the question.
And they want to say, I wasn't trying to lie and say, I was sorry about any of it, because I think that it should have been done, and I had time to do it and resources to do it.
Right.
So I'm fine with doing those things, contacting people or reporting back to the group, unless you think I'm inept. And that's okay with me. For you to tell me, I think that we should be focus solely on getting the best job that we can. So,
I mean, the it's good for us and for other people. I mean, it's good for other people to see what we all decide to do.
I agree.
It's good for us because I forget what we said sometimes. So.
You're not that old.
Well,
so would your suggestion then be that we do them item by item if we do action items, or that we have a list at the end that we read and say,
I would say that we do them as we do them. If there's something we think is important that needs to be done, we need to make a motion to do it.
At the time.
I think that's my personal opinion.
And it sounded like to me that was the intent of this, was so that things didn't get dropped.
Right, absolutely. So we appreciate this being done, absolutely.
So it sounds like.
And I don't really have a problem with, in this document, I think all the things we said we were gonna do, I think we probably would have voted about it. I'm okay with that. But I just mean for further, we need to probably hold this thing.
I agree, because it was an assumption on our part that Nancy was taking a lot of these and, you know, you don't want to assume that Nancy gets stuck doing all the work.
And I am thankful for all the work everybody has done. Andy taking the notes and Nancy making the contacts, that's been a big help, but it should be all of our responsibility to do those things. So do we want to, is there any more discussion on this document, or do we want to make a motion about the changes? Is there any more changes that we should have in there?
I make a motion to approve the document standard.
Amendment.
With that amended change.
Should we have Andy read it first?
Yeah.
Yeah, read the changes, yeah.
All right, so review of two documents for math standards for grade 5 and 6, Massachusetts 2000 for mathematics and CCSS.
That's number
3 and 4.
4 would change to 7.
Four, right, to 7 and 8.
Yeah.
Julie, you start this. Do you want to do that?
Don't you take this a second?
I think that's what
Julie
was doing.
So we have motion second. All those in favor? All opposed? So we've done that now for October 2nd, and now we need to go back and look at October 3rd.
So I'm assuming similar changes then for the 3rd, 4, 5, and then.
Yeah, number 2 should probably say 6, 7, and 8, because we actually.
Five. Yeah, except it's just 7 and 8 on 2. We'd already finished 6.
No, we mentioned 6 as well. We went back and reviewed 6.
As on the 3rd, we had to go back and do that. It was one more finish.
Yeah, we did some 6.
Well, the paragraphs that was working on 6 today, or just the finish today.
Would it be best to say which standards document in the paragraph under Statement 2?
That's why I said make the same change for. Oh, sorry.
Yeah, actually, I think Nancy's motion, I'm just going by memory, but I think she actually did list both Massachusetts and Common Core in the motion.
Yes, I do
remember
the room at the time,
Ann,
when I made the motion.
Yeah,
and I went back and I reviewed the video, so I made sure that I was capturing what people had said. But you guys say what you things should be there.
And again, we're talking about two.
In the paragraph,
the motion,
that Nancy moved that the liaison's report to the state board that we have reviewed the standards documents. I would just like, I would like the standards documents.
To put those in parentheses. Okay. Because it may not have been specifically stated, but I think that would be.
I
Fred says the very first day we talked about that. Fred has joined the Dropbox, as far as my message is sent.
Has everyone had enough time to review the notes?
Almost. I'm sorry for that.
Sorry. So, any discussion on the minutes from October 3rd?
I would move that the minutes be accepted as amended.
Sorry.
As amended, how?
And with just that first paragraph. So after standards documents, we will include in parens Massachusetts 2000 math and CCSSF.
And then we have to somehow address number 6.
I know.
Yeah, I think it was, I think what we did in number 6 was approve based on changes.
Right.
But we didn't see those changes until afterwards, so I don't know how we want to word that, but it was tentative approval based on changes. That's what we really did.
So
we actually approved them today, so.
So do we want to amend your amendment?
I would be glad to.
Okay, so would you restate that then? The amended motion, your motion again?
Sure.
To accept the minutes with the standards.
Okay.
You know, the two documents as Ann just said, and then with Bob's suggestion on number 6 that there was tentative approval of previous minutes. I don't know. Or on suggested changes,
or you could put at the end subject to final approval.
That's fine.
There you go.
Okay.
Fine.
That would be better because you could say tentative.
So. Approval of previous minutes subject to changes, is that what you want that to say? Okay. Okay, so is that your amendment?
I will.
Okay.
So, amen.
Okay.
And I'll second.
Okay. All those in favor? Anita's proof? Okay. All right. So, so any other discussion before we get started on our work? Okay,
Well, we have our tentative agenda, and again, welcome to Beverly. So glad that you're here today. Glad that you're able to join us, and that Fred and Lisa are here able to join us as well today. So I just want to say we've got a lot of work done the last time, because I think we were very focused, zeroed in, and we have a limited amount of time today, so we want to, I think, do the best job that we possibly can in getting as much done as we possibly can for the day. Where we left off, and tell me if I am incorrect, but where we left off in the standards is that we had looked at the number of operations at both Massachusetts and the Common Core, and we were partway through the algebra on the Common Core, and I think we had looked at the 9-10 algebra on the Massachusetts standards. Is that correct? Anybody remember anything different? That's kind of where I left my notes. But we had not looked at the 11-12 Massachusetts standard, so we forgot to do that. So shall we go ahead? We didn't have much to finish with looking at the Common Core document. Does anybody have any objection to finishing those standards that we have left with the algebra session in the Common Core, and then going back and looking at the Massachusetts standards and the functions that will look at those? Julie, no question.
Okay. Well, I do. I you know when we had planned to meet on October second and third, right. The dates before that, when we were planning those times, I think all of us are for sure, myself, you know, we felt like getting all the way through the, you know, the grade 6 coming, and of course we did look at 5 too, because we felt like that
sure.
was, you know, we had to sort of see where that was. And I think, so for me, I had not, and I think I was probably starting to get a little tired at the end of the day, but I had not, you know, spent a lot of time in that, in the time in between, you know, really looking at, you know, the Algebra 1 and higher. And so I've gone back to that, and I did spend a lot of time going through some of that, you know, in preparation for this meeting. And I just have some general comments, and I don't have to start with those, but, you know, on the Algebra 1.
So which document are you looking at?
Well, right. So we had started comparing, or we had gone through both Massachusetts and Common Core, and we just were looking back and forth, and mm-hmm. you know, and kind of talking it through that way. And I know we did talk a little bit about, you know, the overarching organizational system, but I wanted to make kind of a general comment, you know, about that.
Sure.
And I know this is less of a problem with the Algebra 2. But with the Algebra 1, which I think is super important, you know, looking through the standards, the way they're written, and the easiest way to do this is to look at the Appendix A.
Oh, you're looking at the Common Core document.
Common Core. Algebra 1, yeah, sorry. And, you know, and looking at that, and, you know, you're reading, you've got this double column system on the unit. So, well, you can kind of start on page 17 of the appendix, right? Yeah. And, you know, beyond the fact that I find the units not necessarily related to a lot of the standards that are under them, it's as if there's this, you know, astonishing to me disconnect between the title and the standard. And then in addition to that, you look at things that don't apply to the topics that you have in Algebra 1. And so then you, in order to understand what you're expected to do, you have to refer back to the left column where it's titled Skills to Maintain and the so-called instructional notes after that. And I think that sort of bothers me as an organizational system. I feel like, and I don't know if this is the, you know, the old lawyer coming out to just complain, but yeah, well, so, and, you know, but I look at this and I think, you know, is it a standard or is it an instructional note, and why do I have to go through and, you know, sort of flip back and forth?
If
ABC is what you mean, can you say ABC? And so, you know, yeah, and I don't mean to try to cut you off, but I wanted to make that issue, you know, that I mean, we talked about last time, you know, this idea that we have standards that a, you know, a young teacher in a country school or a small district could, you know, sort of understand with a, you know, and maybe you still have to do a lot of work, but at least I find this with, you know, as much math knowledge and math teaching experience and other kinds of background as I have, I find it somewhat difficult and highly annoying to keep flipping back and forth in this organizational structure. And I mean, I'm trying to, you know, overstate, but I just think that's really something
we need to look at. I don't think any of us really disagree with that.
I agree. I mean, I thought the same thing. I actually would rather look at on page 8.
Right.
Because then I can see exactly the things they've listed in algebra 1. But I agree.
Page 16, it has even, if you look at page 16 on that, it just,
you know, I don't think the units, I wasn't even considering that when we spoke before. I was talking more about the,
I agree.
The actual standard.
Overview.
And I'm not sure that that's our direction, is to put units down.
I
think that's beyond the scope of probably this dean is to try to put, because that's kind of like almost dictating the curriculum.
So I think we're in sync there too.
Yeah, and I think the issue, I mean, to me, I would like to, my wish would be we could have a set of standards for algebra 1,
right.
A set of standards for algebra 2. Now, I know why there's overlap, because there is overlap.
Yeah.
And they wanted to have overarching kinds of things, you know, because there are, if you look, I mean, if you look at that starting on page 8, I mean, n is number. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, there are number things, and so they were trying to put the standards themselves in these broad categories.
Right.
But, you know, I don't know how we want to do that, but I would feel much better, too. I mean, I agree with Julie. If in the end we had a set of standards for algebra 1 and for algebra 2 and for geometry, even if they happen twice, I'd still be okay with that. I'd rather be organized that way.
Julie, how do you feel about the organization on page 8 through 15 or whatever it is?
So you're talking about back in the
in front of where you were, yeah.
8 through 6.
That's what I thought. Okay. Right.
Should move it further? Oh, 8 years as long.
Of course, the confusing thing is they have about 4 versions of that based on early algebra, early algebra, math, you know, integrated math, and all those things. But I mean, 8 is a good guideline for just traditional.
And I don't want to put units together. Our direction. I think our direction is really to define what standards we think should be in Algebra 1, define what standards should be in Geometry, define what standards should be in Algebra 2. And Bob's absolutely right. There are certain things that you're going to do. Solve equations involving linear and absolute value is probably Algebra 1, but solving equations involving exponential and logarithmic would be in Algebra 2. So we're going to solve equations, but at different grades depending upon what functions are being studied at the time. So, yeah, I think probably, and I have no idea how they were written, but it was probably like by the end of high school, this is what should be done. And then they had to split that apart, which I think makes it confusing for a lot of folks. So I think that can make it.
Kathy, my understanding also is that Algebra 1 focused on linear, quadratic, and exponential.
Yes.
And kind of got those together. And yes, you're right, there is a little bit of absolute and a little bit of piecewise in certain places. But in general, that it focused there. And it was more on skills.
Yeah.
Algebra 2 is more about modeling and more about analyzing. Even if you go back to the exponential or go back to any of the linear or the quadratic, it's more about in a modeling context. And so the skills are developed in Algebra 1, specifically those 3, very strongly. And then when they get to, and because those are things they're going to be using in Geometry as well.
Yes.
And then as they get to Algebra 2, you revisit them, but you put them in a modeling context and really pump up those STEM things. Okay? So,
you know, and I completely agree with Nancy that that's the way to, you know, sort of make this make sense, and that's the right way to do it. But I just, you know, for example, if you read, you know, you have this FIF4 for function that models a relationship, blah, 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 and you go through key features and clues, blah, 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 list them, relative maximums and minimums, and, you know, and periodicity, and you look up and you think, wait, I thought we were in the linear and exponential section, and you look up, yes. Yeah. And so I feel like I get it because I know what those things are, but the reality is that, you know, we have, I mean, and this is not to, you know, because I think some middle school teachers are great, but you know, when we're looking at, you know, we have some middle school teachers that are going to look at those things.
I think we're all about giving a document that teachers can read and utilize.
Absolutely.
And understand, comprehend it.
And I would be all in favor of the kinds of things that you see in the progressions document where it explains what's going on here as part of what we do here. Don't have five different documents you have to look at and five different places to see it, but at one place.
Right.
I think that's really, I agree, that's very important.
Very important, because teachers are limited on time.
Yes.
Absolutely limited on time if you have all of it in front of you.
Right.
And they may be limited on knowing which document to look at which time. Right. So I think we're with you.
Yeah, absolutely.
And I think that's important to do. I'm sorry. But I just, you know, you do want, I mean, even if you end up repeating something, you know, you have it here and then you have it somewhere else, but maybe the focus is a little bit different. But I think that, you know, it not only is accessible for busy teachers, you know, but just, you know, something that, you know, parents can look at and think, you know, that they kind of get it, even if they're, you know, not engineers or whatever. And
you
so,
do I best be clear?
The, I do. And so I think that that's something that we, you know, I just wanted to, and I'm super excited to hear all these comments.
Thumbs up,
yeah, we agree. I think that all of us probably better really want it to be as clear as possible for the teachers and have clear standards for Algebra 1, clear standards for Geometry, clear standards for Algebra 2, so they don't have to flip back and forth of what part of the standard do I do in Algebra 1. And I would rather repeat the standard specifically for the functions that they're studying than have. You know, I think we need to keep in mind those global overarching ideas of what we want kids to be able to do by the time they graduate. But I think we need to clearly define it for Algebra 1, Geometry, and Algebra 2. I agree with you wholeheartedly.
So we're talking about how the documents will be organized.
Yes.
This may be consistent with science and English.
That would be a nice thing, wouldn't it?
Another copy.
Yes. I don't know that we have any say in how that's going to happen.
I'm just wondering if that's something we should try to find out, because if we spend a lot of our time talking about organization and the best way to organize it, and someone else's ideas, they're going to come in and take the standards and then put them in a standard format so that it's consistent across disciplines. I could see that happening, because it seems like it would be, I mean, they're always the same to make it, you know, ease of interpretation by teachers who teach multiple subjects or professional development people or administrators and so on.
It's really never been the way.
It hasn't.
No, I mean, yeah. Everything we've ever had has been different for different subjects. So
and Common Core is different.
The Glees and the Glees have been set up the same.
I can tell you why, because they started with math as an organizational that everybody was told they had to follow it that way. I don't think told they had to follow it that way. I think they tried to make it, and I don't think it works as well, because some content areas may not relate as easily. You know, the structure that was put for math, people were analytical and putting step by step, which was not necessarily a good thing, but I think everybody then afterwards did theirs in the same way. I don't know if that is the case. I think elementary probably might benefit from that more so than secondary wouldn't.
Even Common Core, the coding in Common Core for elementary is different as for high school.
But if we do by course, which I agree with them, I think is a good idea, that it seems that science should do theirs by course as well.
Well, and then language arts.
Yeah.
Yeah. I would assume they probably would, but I guess we shouldn't assume anything. And I'm not sure who we would be able to contact, Nancy.
Did you want to say something, Julie?
No, I was going to make that comment, you know, that we have talked about as we go through, you know, different places, where, like when we talked about units and dimensional analysis, and that will come up again, but, you know, that we have talked about, you know, making sure that we have some consistency with, you know, the level of where, you know, versus science that, you know, that so that we get to teach it, so to speak, rather than, you know, necessarily, you know, the science teachers having to do it, or, you know, that there's some kind of consistency. I mean, I feel like that is something that, you know, that we have talked about. Mm-hmm. But I also was just going to say, you know, as far as the science courses, I mean, they'll pretty much have to do by the force, I think.
Well, I want to say that once we do settle on what our design is, mm-hmm. then I do think that that would be an action item for.
Absolutely.
To, and I would be willing to contact the ELA and the science to let them know what we're doing. We can't, of course, I don't think that we can tell them what to do, but to say, to lend consistency, we wanted to share with you how we are going to organize our information, course by course, and to, so that ease of use for teachers.
Right.
And curriculum people.
Well, even if we arrange it the way we are talking about, it still wouldn't be impossible to make them all look similar once we have everything straight.
Correct.
That it seems like having a common format, which is look very unified.
That would be nice. I just think we might want to know that before going in, so that the work isn't taken and manipulated in ways we hadn't planned. And
I'm sure we are the most advanced.
Everyone's just waiting for our work.
They are.
They're waiting for us.
Well, I would suggest, I mean, maybe what we want to do then is to actually start doing some dividing and say, okay, let's look what should be in Algebra 1 and look at both documents and see the things, the standards and the way we look at that. A good way to start?
Well, I think it is, or it can be. I mean, I do think that, you know, we talked about last time the, you know, ultimately we have to make sure that we're not saddling the Algebra 1 teachers down with, you know, way, way too much stuff and recognizing you know, that there's a lot, and there's a lot on their plates right now, I think. So, you know, to try to do that. And then when you look at the Algebra 2, you feel like, you know, if everybody came in knowing the Algebra 1, you really wouldn't have to do all that much. And and that's not my goal, you know, even though I succeed Algebra 2. But I'm not kidding. I do think that's something, you know, you have to ask yourself, you know, is this something that, you know, is developmentally appropriate? Because I know that, you know, I teach the honors class, and sometimes people say to me, well, how can you have kids in honors algebra 2 who, you know, are juniors, you know? And I said, well, you can, you know, because they cannot be ready in the 8th grade and then be ready as 11th graders and be the best student in your room, you know, and that is an issue. So you just have to target, you know, what's the average kid going to be ready to do, and then secondarily, you know, is this something that, you know, can wait? Because if it can, I mean, we do have to have some things wait, because, you know, the Algebra 1 people need more time to develop things, and so I do think that's really something to bear in mind. But overall, I don't know if we can decide all of that up front. I mean, I think that's going
to
be...
I think as we're going through it, we're going to be able to see that's obvious Algebra 1, that's obvious Algebra 2, and we're going to have those shades of gray that we're really not sure where this is really going to fit. But whatever we do, we don't want to overwhelm one. Because, like you said, Algebra 2, I've heard teachers that are just the opposite and say Algebra 2, they're fine with Algebra 1, but Algebra 2 is just overpacked. Okay. So, yeah.
So I always thought Algebra 1 was the most packed curriculum ever. And I really think it's important to build skills.
Yes.
And that's not saying keep all contextual problems out of Algebra 1, but to focus on the skills in 1 and build that solid foundation so that they can apply in Algebra 2.
Right.
And I think we did already talk about, even when we're talking middle school, how it's nice to say that it's going to go here, but we did say that we had to keep in mind that we're actually doing the right thing with Algebra 1.
And I think committees would come back and tell why they recommended as such.
Right. And then we look at it and make sure that as we're doing things, it's not overbalanced. Because I think I mentioned once before that one of the things we don't want to have happen is someone look at the number of standards of what we have and divide it by the number of days of our teaching. That's how many days you put per standard, and that has happened. And so, you know, we want to make sure that we might really give people enough time to really redevelop those ideas.
You know, one thing that I did at our school, you know, I started like teaching in the Algebra 1 level and moving up, and in the Algebra 1 we always did orders of operations and then also the distance formula, midpoint formula. You know, once they had gotten down the orders of operations, and so knowing that they were going to use that again in Algebra 2, and with geometry being in between, I thought it was worth taking the time when we were talking about circles
and points equidistant from the center point that we actually involve the distance formula, you know, again. And that is in the Common Core. That was one of the things that I thought was kind of interesting in there. But so those kind of things teachers are going to do anyway, you know.
Well, most teachers.
Or we could have, you know, we could have, you know, appendix of suggestion
Well, I do think that, you know, when for, you know, which I'm sure is an overwhelming majority of Missouri districts that do Algebra 1, Geometry, Algebra 2, and so you do have the need, and because they are young kids, you know, you have to go back and do some of that algebra review, and so you need to have time, you know, to do that in many lessons in Algebra 2, I've been outside the box thinker at times, and I know that you guys were all giggle about this, but Kathy's story about, you know, was it an administrator that we were, of course it was, and who would take the GLEs and divide them by, you know, number days in the school year and say, this is how you go. And so, and I mean this as a serious comment, you know, and Bob maybe can help us figure it out, but I think the abuse of math is an important topic, and maybe it goes under statistics and we'll get there eventually, but I do think that, you know, that if I'm, you know, if somebody's asking me, you know, what would you like to have, Julie, I would say, that's something I would like to see a nod for that, you know, because I do think that happens a lot, so.
Yeah, and the idea that all standards are created equal, you know, that's certainly
I'll take one day, yeah, exactly. One standard could take a week and another standard could take
There is stuff like that in statistics in terms of, there's a nice standard about the correlation is not causation.
Right.
So there's some good things like that.
HSSFDC 9.
That's right. 9? That's right. Yep. I did
love it. So, are we going to start splitting it up? Or are we going to continue like we were and talk about things we don't think belong or words we don't like? Or are we going to start splitting it up?
I don't know if we have, because I think in order to, we need to have, if I'm not mistaken, a quorum to sit down and talk about which standards, what we like, what we don't like, and then I think look at splitting them after that. But I would really like, if we can, to really get focused on, because all the discussion has been absolutely marvelous, but to try the best we can to get the algebra and functions done between Massachusetts and the Common Core and look at those. And I think the next thing was to look at geometry to see, you know, to look at the geometry standards, and I think that the last item on the agenda, what last thing was, be to look at the data analysis and how that's going to be. Nancy?
We also, if you don't mind, Madam Chair, need to talk about when we want to meet with the K through 5 group.
Because
to make that seamless.
The K through 5 group did want to meet with us. That's what they said, and I asked specifically why, and they said really to look at their organization and structure to make sure that was going to work for both sides.
And it may be that, of course, I mean, maybe we've done enough with 6 through 8 to talk to them about that, because I think that would be what they'd be most concerned about.
Yeah, I think so too.
Where we started.
I agree. So if we're going to do that, what would be the best time? Because I think we could shoot somebody an email and get a response from them while we're working here. When would you prefer to do that? Would you prefer to do it before lunch or after?
I think we should take a shortened lunch today. We've got so much to do, and we're only taking one day. So whenever we have lunch, I hope that it's a free day, and the cafeteria is right there. So we take a shortened lunch, and then I can communicate with them and ask them, did anyone here have a preference over this morning or afternoon?
Are they here all day today? Because last time they didn't start.
I think the other
here.
They are starting.
I think so.
Yeah. So we could do it maybe at 11. And we could
right
do it
before we go to lunch.
11:30.
And you want to do it right after lunch?
No, right before we go to lunch.
Between 11 and 11:15, you know that?
We give them like 3 minutes.
It's meet with them starting sometime between 11 and 11:15.
Yeah, that's fine.
Yeah, as still working in the classroom member of the group here, I would like to say that I can eat in 20 minutes.
Or less.
And I can be in the bathroom. No,
but do you get to get in front of line?
Well, we do allow that, yes. And that was my thing. So I'm fine meeting with them whenever, but do we sustain an advantage by getting there before noon? Do we, by taking
so. It starts to get crowded about 11:30-ish.
Yeah, so.
So that if we say like a 20:30, that would after the crowd. Either before or after the crowd. So which one would you prefer?
Meet at 11, you're saying, for 20 minutes?
Or less.
For 18 minutes, Julie?
That sounds fine.
20 minutes is a perfect number.
That is true.
I want to go with the Fibonacci number.
So meet at 11?
Beverly suggests an imaginary number.
An imaginary number.
Well, meet with, how about if we meet with them at E? Okay, is 11 to, is 11:20 okay with everyone?
If we're inviting them down here, since we're closest to the cafeteria.
Yeah, well, it's
they're upstairs.
It's going to be a crowded room.
Yeah, it'd be very crowded.
I don't know if they're
and the room upstairs isn't any bigger.
Okay.
So,
well, but they can line up and go home.
Does the whole group need to meet with the whole group, or could that be one of the things where we, I'm just throwing it out there.
Especially if you're going to break up at some point, everybody needs to hear the discussion.
Absolutely.
Okay, so I'm going to invite them to our room
at 11.
From 11 to 11:20 and tell them we're not going to be rude, but we're kicking their butts out at 11:20.
Well, I think it helps to get really focused. If we are, you know, it could go on forever, so it helps to get really focused to make those decisions. So, okay, is that okay with Erica?
You go for it, Nancy.
Anybody have any objections to that?
Then we can have an abbreviated lunch after that and get back to business.
And get back to business, because we got lots to do.
Yeah, and I agree that I think it's super important that we finish the algebra one and look at geometry. I mean, if we don't get to algebra two, I don't see a huge deal with that, because that's kind of
I think if we get to the data and functions in geometry,
and the data
could be something that I think is critical. However, we could look at that as to what goes appropriate, what place. And you know, that wouldn't necessarily have to be a decision today.
Right.
Okay. So, shall we get back into the document looking at, like I said, we got through all of the patterns and relationships in the Massachusetts document last time, the grades 9 and 10. However, we did not look at 11 and 12, and we do need to go back and look at that. So do we want to finish off where we stopped with the common core? And for those of you that weren't here, there were a few of you who weren't here last time, one of the things we did say that when we were looking at some of the plus standards that we liked, that were in the common core document, we had talked about making a separate, because we're talking about what's good for all kids, about making a separate document for those kids going into science, engineering, and math, because we had had that discussion about this is what we want all kids to have, but beyond that scope, for kids going to science, engineering, careers, these are also important items. So that was a topic for discussion. We didn't make any decisions.
May I ask, how many people here would like a bound copy of the Common Core with appendix? Four. So if we take just a break and imagine Bob running to my car.
Imagine.
It's not imaginary.
They're just shrunk. And I apologize. I meant to put them in my little suitcase when I came in, and I didn't.
So does anybody, do we want to take, does anybody need a
just a
break?
5 minute, a four,
a sprint. Bob. Anybody needs to use the restroom, but this would be the time where we'll come back in about 5-8 minutes.
I think they're in the box in the front.
I sure hope they're there when she's saying this, because the one she's giving is going to have
more. I really love it. I'm going to be finished with you, so I'm
going to sit. Bring it back on
camera. I'm going to be a little boy, 5 minutes.
Shopping.
So I have a feeling I'm going to come back.
I need that my mom's garage. She has one.
Those are what he is, what Jay is creating.
Oh, thank you.
You
know, I recognize your name.
Okay, I know we've run each other somewhere.
Yes.
She was a lot of flowers in there too, but thank you.
That's what I just, that we got, it's super fun, we get jam, we get, you know, what I mean, it's on the season, and you're there, but.
We were kind of.
She's got some, for his fourth children here. It's a Spider-Man, we had had a weekend, we keep the little guys in, some combinations of special cooking, so that we want to get. With anything to do before. After we take this, okay, now that I called the restroom break, I guess I'd better do it again,
going to recommend, how will they, I guess, correlate with the EOCs?
I don't know. I mean, I think that's yet to be determined. Some of the Massachusetts standards we're having are not radically different, so it may just be a little the teacher's current standard first. There hasn't been any new work looking at. I mean, when we did the crosswalk between CLE and the college, 90 to 95% of them were on that.
So that's why
I'm kind of thinking we're about 85 to 95% match.
Right, you're going to have
a little move
for your standards.
Right, but you're going to have a map of
who needs copies.
About the EOCs to whatever we do.
Did anybody else have that?
You said they'll adapt them?
Yeah.
I think you want yourself, I feel like that.
We went through the.
She has more at the car, we need to over lunch. Bob will be in.
So I think it's back to that item pay.
Do they have the money for that? I mean, because if not, shouldn't we at least make sure that whatever we're recommending is something that is assessed? I mean, you would want to be assessed on something that's not one of our standards.
The statute requires them to develop the assessments
after
they're by the end of the year. So we're going to look for this year.
The plan goes after it goes to the board, depending on what the board says. Then I think it's so we know we'll have what we have now,
for next year.
I was just reading the October discussion, thought generally about
when I look at the blueprint for, you know,
I was just curious that they were there, and I know I've read people's opinions, but I don't know if I'm streamlined because there's so many things that have to be.
So we'll make sure that they need the same thing.
I just, when I was on my other friend, I was trying to share. I think you're very informative about opportunities to read.
Right, and I think part of it is we just, a big part of our discussion.
Oh, I'm not really, I mean, all of your point of view.
She is today.
Yeah.
Is that a song? It will be one now. It is one now.
I'm not really.
No, I think it's. My name is Tuesday. So.
And then I always do, so I have to suggest my thing that I'm worrying about after.
Now my boss,
they do, well, they do a little bit of like crime.
So let's go ahead and if we can finish our conversation and then get back on task. And because it could be that within an hour the fifth grade advisory body group, so we really haven't started. We've had some good discussion. We need to clarify that we do need to get back into the document and start looking at things. So the last time is we had finished off the 9 and 10 standards for mathematics for Massachusetts. We're going to look at those and address those for algebra. We have not looked at 11 and 12. And we had gotten through, and somebody tell me if I'm not mistaken, that on the algebra for the Common Core, we have gotten through, I think, page 64, number 1, understanding the polynomial form of system analogous to integers. Close and closure.
We had also covered at least part of, I'll call it the REI, because we had talked about solving systems
right.
And that had parabolas and.
So we had, yeah, we had kind of talked about that. We talked about that, yes. So should we start on looking at? Going through a few more of the items on the Common Core document that we had not finished up yet, and then go back to Massachusetts 11 and 12. What's your pleasure?
Well, is it not true that the Massachusetts 11 and 12 would be what they consider algebra 2? Is that not what you would assume?
I would assume algebra 2 and pre-calculus, because 11 and 12, I would make some assumptions that you, because when I looked at that, I saw some items that could go either way. It could go in pre-calculus or it could go in algebra 2.
And I think in that respect, and I know this is what Kathy was saying right before we took our break, and everyone wants to take that topic again. One final comment as to that post-algebra 2. I would like to preserve that flexibility. You know, some districts want to do, you know, a pre-calc. If you're, and I would like to see, you know, even in my district, you know, I would like to offer the more in the way of statistics. Maybe stats. And so I think when you're trying to preserve that sort of flexibility, I mean, I think listing topics is a good thing, and I think we should make an effort to do that in a thoughtful way, but not in a kind of a mandatory thing either. So,
yeah.
And then some of it, if you have time with your honors kids, you're maybe going to do that analysis.
Right. So keep that in mind as we're going through it. So, do we want to continue finishing up the, just kind of briefly looking over what the Common Core says? Because you're right, some of that got in when we were talking about the Massachusetts documents.
We said that because we agreed with Liz here. I'm not sure, though, when we looked at the Massachusetts document, that said anything specifically about the remainder term. I don't think we addressed that in this group meeting.
What page are you on?
On page 64 in the Common Core document. Because I don't think it came up, if I'm not mistaken, on the Massachusetts document, at least in 910.
Is this your page?
No,
that's the page.
What page?
Page, I think it's page 64, so it's part of the document. Yeah, there's an appendix in there, yeah.
Actually, in the front.
In the front, sorry about that.
And wasn't that in the appendix in Algebra 1, it says no, that's an algebra 2 thing or something like that?
The remainder theorem.
The remainder theorem, I think it's something, and I don't know, I just think that are we in agreement that's something that we should be doing, the remainder there?
I think that we should be doing it, Kathy, but I think that it should have some connection to actually long division, not just synthetic division. To get some meaning out of it, not just another algorithm for kids to perform. Because I don't think that I think that they can do the remainder theorem with synthetic division, but I don't know that it has any meaning if they're really getting what remainder means.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
So I think that maybe we should, you know, if they want to end up doing it or connecting the long division to synthetic division, okay. But I think that we should stress somehow that we like the long division.
So maybe under APR 1, we should include division and not just add, subtract, and multiply.
Well, I think, but are we saying that we would do that long division in algebra 1?
No.
I think we would do it in algebra 2.
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
No, I agree. I caught it in 1. Bam.
We introduced it in algebra 1 when I taught it with like linear divisors, and then in algebra 2 again with quadratic or higher degree divisors, and so that kind of builds it.
And I think that's really up to the individual school districts, that if you would want to choose to teach long division in algebra 1 as a precursor, but in algebra 2 they have to know how to do that. Does that make sense?
I agree that we can either move it up to 1 or we can leave it at 2,
yeah,
and stress there that we want to see it connected to long division,
right,
and synthetic division possibly.
Yeah.
And that was my sense. You know, I don't mind teaching synthetic division, but I always wanted it to be addition, not in place of, because I find it a non-transparent. It's quicker, but it's too murky, I think. So maybe that's not the right word, but.
Well, I think too often we just teach synthetic substitutions and synthetic division without really going through the process.
Without doing it right. Well, and that's not how I do it, but
right.
I agree that we clarify that.
Yeah, I agree.
For the future.
Well, the zero product property doesn't seem to come up anywhere in either one of these, but it is in the California standards. And that kind of ties into this idea of division and, you know, the rational root theorem. So I just want to mention that briefly.
Well, I'm going to write that down in my notes, the zero problem, because you're right.
That's something that we all have to reteach over and over again, but if you look for it as a standard, it's hard to find.
So I wrote that down in the notes.
Isn't it part of, I mean, it's done quadratic.
Mm-hmm. I'm talking just generally.
If you say the property itself means it well, I don't think that you have to teach this as the zero property to teach the concept. The concept appears multiple times in high school. It appears in SSE 3, factor of quadratic expression to reveal the zero to the function it defines. Necessarily, you are doing that. It is in APR 3, identify the zeros of a polynomial, consider if suitable factorizations are available. So I think it's inherent in those standards that you are going to that you're going to know
that you're going to use
not just factor, but you're going to find out what
I
don't want to use the wrong word, variable, the letter stands for.
But just an example of a real common error in every class, including calculus, an equation like, you know, 2x times x minus 3 equals 0. And students will write down x equals 2, 0, and 3. They will.
Well, yes, but Lisa, that's up to the teacher to correct. That's not about a standard. That's, we can't tell, the standard can't be teacher teach the standard.
But that is an issue at a grade when they're learning to multiply and how things do it.
Well, I was going to say, you know, in the standards, there are things like, you know that there is a number I that's the square root of negative 1,
right,
and that a plus bi is complex number, blah, blah, blah. You know, and it's true, the zero product property is clearly implicit, and you could not possibly factor a solve without it. But I wonder, I mean, like, here's one that goes with that, you know, that a fraction can't be zero unless the numerator is that, like, somewhere? Because kids don't learn that, and they need to know it.
Yeah, but I think both things you're talking about are back in elementary school, mm-hmm, that the product is zero and any number is zero, that... you know, I mean, I think those are elementary things, but you're right, this is building on it.
Well, so do you think as we start going, hopefully, fewer topics for the poor elementary teachers and more understanding, do you think eventually we'll see that feed up and maybe some of these problems we have now when they're covering 200 things in a year will maybe fix themselves, hopefully? If they'll stay home.
I mean, what you're talking about is an application of something they should know a long time ago,
right.
And I think that's the thing that we want to be careful of. That's the thing Common Core tried to do, was not say, okay, well, let's make sure in ninth grade we cover everything they should have done in eighth and seventh grade.
Right. And
then you get that huge list like the GLEs. And,
yeah. And you know, I mean, the brain research that I have read indicates that when a student learns a concept, you know, at a certain stage, then it becomes automatic for later stages. But what I'm saying, just as a teacher, is I have retaught that basic concept in Algebra 1, Geometry, Algebra 2, and in Calculus.
And
at some point, it did not become automatic, you know.
And the grim part, sometimes it doesn't have a connection, because the example you gave, what I think the kids don't pick out is that 2 is 2, and 2 being the factors, so they don't understand factors. And so that's a piece, and I wrote down that I have in here zero product property, that we probably need, you know, that somehow we need to make sure that teachers understand that property themselves. That I think absolutely right, Julie and Nancy, too. It's been done before.
I think one thing that helps with that, too, is this little thing over here on the next page on creating equations.
Yeah,
I think when students have a context, where you create a quadratic equation that, you know, we do that for college algebra, where you create that needs a context, and then the zeros have a meaning. They make sense. And so, you know, the fact that one of them is zero, I mean, I think it doesn't fix everything, but I think that helps with that understanding a lot. So, yeah.
I agree. It's like kind of making those connections between the two. On the polynomials in number 3, identifying series of polynomials when pseudo factorizations are available, I think that's very appropriate. Any discussion about that?
No, and I like that they have them construct a graph.
Me too. Mm-hmm. I think that really helps me get calculus for the, when you're talking about the misconceptions that are there. So, given the zeros, being able to construct a graph.
Okay, that number 3 that we were talking about.
Sure.
I guess I'm nitpicking on this stuff.
No,
identify zeros with polynomial equations. I mean, polynomials have factors, but equations have zeros. So
that's great.
And I'm only nitpicking on your
point. Well, no, I'm really glad. No, that's good to have.
I can't.
Identify zeros with polynomial equations.
Yeah, I think actually we're talking about polynomial functions.
Well, polynomial equations, functions.
It says function later on.
Polynomial functions, okay.
Okay, well, like.
But that's just polynomial, because a polynomial just has factors.
That you're right.
So if you're identifying the zeros of polynomial equations.
I would say functions, because, well, let's see.
Then you would.
That's what the section's called.
The second part is, I think, what's causing the problem, maybe. It should be used, the zeros, to construct a rough graph of the related polynomial function, because.
The understanding of relations with zeros.
They're going back and forth between equations and.
I don't think they are. I think they mean functions both times.
I guess even in the college, they have a hard time with, is this an expression? Is it an equation with one variable? Is it an equation with two?
Right.
And so, I mean, I guess this one's underneath connecting the zeros to the factors.
Yeah, I think these are not functions, because I just think they left function out of that first phrase.
I think the function in the second phrase is supposed to.
Imply, but.
But it's essentially just what it's supposed to be about.
Yeah.
Yeah, and just a second, Beverly, and I remember giving notes, I've said this 10 times, you know, language is super important when you're teaching kids.
So I think if we just inserted functions there, it would be okay.
Yeah, I think so.
Okay, so I just inserted functions there. Any other discussion on that? Beverly, are you okay with that?
I'm trying to figure out, because like I'm new at this. But it's just, is this section strictly about?
It's not algebra.
Expressions.
Yeah.
And talking about how the expressions are related.
It does say it's within rational expressions. We have, yeah, it does say in the top, arithmetic with polynomial and rational expressions.
I think it's a hard thing for even the college students to understand. When all of a sudden you've got an equation with one variable, and all of a sudden you're graphing it, and saying these zeros are the solutions to that equation. And,
right.
You know, I try to be really strict about x and y, you've got a graph. You know, x equation, you're going to get numbers.
Right.
And I think this, it constantly flipping around. I think until they've got a little bit more maturity and understanding what's going on, I think that's a confusing sentence.
Well, and I want to say that I don't think that we are actually writing the actual standards right now. We are saying things that we want to see that.
Okay.
That needs to be corrected. This is just talking about, okay, there's a problem here, we need to correct this.
So we might put a function or an equation out to the side, and then when your group or whoever group does that, they'll be the one
that wants to see that.
And it is under the arithmetic with polynomials and rational expressions, which is a problem.
That's a problem.
Yeah, it is. And we wouldn't, obviously, I mean, we're going to create our own document, so this is the wording, and so we have to look at that, because we haven't decided how we're going to group things together yet.
I skipped over five because that's got the plus sign.
Right.
Then you look at six, and you know, to me, again, that's, you know, that polynomial long division, and that's what, you know, I would support as indicating that, you know, that we should include that. So, I mean, that goes with the remainder.
I agree.
So,
can you repeat that, please?
So I'm looking at the number six, and it says rewrite rational expressions of the heading, which I'll stop talking about how this ends, because I think some of these headings are, but I just feel like that, you know, rewriting simple rational expressions, blah, blah, blah. I just think that's, again, that polynomial long division, and the remainder theorem goes with that. I don't know why they're separated, but.
Well, they haven't really mentioned long division, but they do there.
They do there, yeah. And that's what I just, you know, I feel like, you know, this tennis match head flipping is, you know.
I agree. I think they tied together.
Yeah, it's not right.
I don't really think number seven should be a plus standard. Not for algebra 2, personally.
What's the star mean in the header? The asterisks and they're creating equations?
Well, the reason that I'm stating that is at the beginning.
Oh, way at the beginning. Okay.
The reason that I think that, though, and you guys who are more familiar with college algebra, and I know some of the, some changes are happening at the colleges with that, that is a basic expectation, and I have seniors in Algebra 2. And so
when you look at that, Lisa, would you say that they should be able to add, subtract, multiply, divide, rational expressions?
Yeah, but I don't think that's what this is saying.
No, that, I don't think so.
This is about, this is kind of like, we had it in the Massachusetts too, and we talked about getting rid of it, was this seeing something as a system that has closure.
Right.
And I think that's a different thing, because it, because that, the operations with rational expressions, I think, is in here, but I don't think so.
I think it's only there.
And I agree.
Well, then maybe this should be.
That's what I'm saying.
This should be changed to be that, and not about. But the way it's worded here, it's about closure.
Take out the word analogous.
Yeah.
If we took out the word analogous and just said perform operation.
Perform operations on rational expressions.
But it's, that's a, I mean, to me, that's a really important skill that they need to enter college with if they're a senior in Algebra 2. What do you think?
I agree. I think we probably would want to limit the degree because some of the, because then you can get way out of control with some of those. So I agree. I think it should be able to add, subtract, multiply, and divide rational expressions, but we may want to quantify that as to simple rational expressions. Yeah. Because I don't disagree, Beverly, what do you think?
Okay. Yeah, they get hung up the factoring a lot of times with that.
Right. So I think that we do want them to form operations on the rational expressions, but I don't think the closure, I'm not sure that we had talked about it now, and we had talked about another one that, do we want them to?
I think that would be contingent upon making sure you cover the closure really well, but it's just for the, you know, the rational numbers.
Right.
So it was something that wasn't covered a whole lot in that context.
Right.
Now putting it here would make it difficult if they didn't have a context of what it was like.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah, I think the way that this is written, you do sort of end up focusing on that closure, which we did talk about being not all that interesting or important. And but I mean, I do think that as a subtract, multiply, I think if we do limit that to some relatively simple situations, then the really added benefit of that is that they really learn fractions as a result.
And it establishes that for them, and it would help them so much on their placement test for college too. Just with basic fraction operations.
I think the important part that's here, and this may be, who knows what the intent is, but they put this closure thing in there two or three times and we've not liked it. But the part I do like about this is seeing that operations with rational expressions is analogous to operations with rational expressions.
Right.
Because really, adding rational expressions, you do the same thing that you do when you add rational.
Well, and that's what I was thinking.
I think the analogous part is still good.
They do have them solving rational equations other places in this document.
Mm-hmm. Which means they're going to have
the operations to do them. So I do think the closure part is the important part of this one. I think that's why it's plus.
We talked about symmetry, and we kind of left that to the side, but there's some connection between closure and symmetry also on some concepts that they're more overarching. They're not necessarily the details of any of this, but that maybe goes back to what we talked about teachers understanding some of the connections across things and where it's going.
And that's really right. I had a middle school teacher ask me once, what the closure was, because someone had given her an explanation, that she couldn't understand. And, 10 seconds after she finished speaking, she was saying, "Oh, that's really all it means."
Yeah.
And so I think, maybe it would be nice if we spell that out, because it is. And go ahead and call it closure, because that's a technical term, okay, fine. But at least go ahead and say what it is so people are not left thinking, oh, where did
we stand with this one?
Well discussed, it's well discussed.
It's disgusting.
What are the final wording?
Seems like.
I don't know.
We're not final wording.
But it seems like the several people have voiced opinion that all of the plus ought to come on, is what I thought so far.
For algebra two?
Yes.
Yeah, I would think it would be algebra two.
Like, on the Massachusetts document, page 82.
Is that the, we haven't looked at the senior level one yet, so.
Oh, okay, well, it's kind of, you know, along that line.
Yeah, we'll get, yeah, I agree, yeah. So just remember when we go look at that, which one that was.
I'm okay with taking the plus off, I wish we could put a minor, because, I mean, I don't want that to be a huge focus, because as Nancy said, in doing the other things, you have to be able to add, subtract, multiply, and divide.
Right.
Rational expressions, so, you know, my fear would be, and I don't know how we keep this from happening, but, you know, the divide up and do them all the same amount of time, because you spend an inordinate amount of time, you could spend an inordinate amount of time adding, subtracting, multiplying, dividing, rational expressions, and lose a lot of good stuff.
I think you can spend 2 solid months.
Absolutely, yeah, so, I'm not opposed to taking the plus off, but I wish we could put a little minus out the end of it or something, because I think it's covered in other things, but.
Right, and maybe we can put it in other things or somehow, that they need to be able to do that, but we want to keep it as simple rational functions, we don't want some of the rational functions that I've seen out there, that's pre-cal, per-cal, pre-cal, it doesn't belong.
It is, and I mean, I think too, you know, whatever the current trends are in the use of technology in some of these upper level math classes, the reality is technology is here to stay.
Yeah,
and I think we need to respect that, so, but I agree, you could spend 2 months with this, or you could just
I know. In our college algebra, the amount of time that a student would need to be able to do operations with rational expression is about like that.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just, I knew, and there are other ways they could do the things that they need to do with it anyway. I mean, there are ways to, I know there are times when that's all you can do, but there are times when
it's what things. Course are you talking about?
College algebra.
Yeah.
Yeah. So.
But, you know, like, I mean, I kind of view, just in general, college algebra, I view it similarly with algebra 2, because I do have some students that are seniors there, and, you know, I just really feel caution that we don't want to have a dead-end course anywhere.
Oh, absolutely.
And, you know, so that there are pieces that will get them ready if they choose, you know, to receive them.
Well, college algebra is different. Ours is a modeling course, so it's different. It's not the same everywhere, so, yeah.
So I think we're in agreement that we take the plus off, but we reword it and we keep in
the analogous.
Yeah, the analogous and simple operator, and we want to keep it in simple, rational numbers. We don't. But then again, this is not final wording. This is just ideas, so that when we come down and we do put these down, we'll have these ones come on.
I think A, C, E, D, I've already mentioned it once, but I think it's really important in terms of building that basic concept of reinforcing all the things that have come above this about expressions and how they actually can be used to represent real things. And it's important.
I think if we can just solve the equation, but we can't create it, we don't understand the concept combined with it, then we're not doing our job. And they do note they're simple rational and simple exponential. And I guess the other thing, I don't think we would create equations from logarithmic. We can discuss that when we get to that, but if we decide to keep the trig in here, there might be something with trig involved in that. But, are we okay?
Are you talking about number one there?
Yeah.
Trig question mark?
Yeah, because we don't know what we're going to do with a circle trig right now, so that could be a possibility, but we don't know what we're going to do with that yet.
But we're still discussing the concept of, in this case, the linear, quadratic, and exponential being algebra 1 and those rational ones being algebra 2.
Algebra 2, I think the rational belong to algebra.
And even some non-integer exponent exponentials or whatever in algebra 2. Mm-hmm. So it's building a foundation.
Right. for that day students do really fairly well with the simple exponential functions in HB1 and their understanding.
Yeah, and I agree. And I don't want to come back and say, I feel like I'm saying the same thing over and over, but I know with the way that this, this creating equations, modeling, building functions, interpreting functions, I think that's the heart and soul of what you need to do in a, Algebra 2 class. I mean, I think it's closer to Nancy's team, that you are looking at, some of that skill building, maybe a little bit more in Algebra 1, but in Algebra 2. And yes, you will do some modeling now for one two, so I'm not saying you wouldn't, but I'm coming back. So again, I feel like it, just as an organizational issue, it's in here like in three places, and I feel like it should be in one place.
Right. I think that if we put Bob and Julie on that committee, they can write 35 standards for that one, so that when you divide those standards up, it will really get hit on.
Well, I just think, they've separated them in a way with the asterisks here to show the modeling idea, but this is the thing that I think the Common Core is way better than the Massachusetts. And the Massachusetts talks about solving problems.
Right.
Solving problems. But this is about the understanding you have to solve problems.
Right.
And how to use algebra in this case to solve a problem. Because you can say solve a problem using algebra, but this is about how you start to do that. That is creating equations, building functions, creating functions. There's just more to it, and I think that's important.
And I think, Julie, what you said is like it's in multiple different places. And I think part of the problem is teachers don't understand how to connect those. So sometimes it looks like there's a lot of standards there, but all of these can be combined into one. But when we write ours, we need to make sure.
I want it coherent.
I totally agree. Mm-hmm. I just had a real quick comment on number four for the people that do the vocational type and also the science teachers.
Right.
Would that not belong in a little bit in both Algebra 1 and Algebra 2
what you're studying?
Based on what you're studying, I mean, there's certain kinds of equations you can solve for,
You want to see these are the notes I wrote last night, done at both Algebra 1 and Algebra
2. Oh, my
gosh. Hitting them on equations.
That's bizarre.
So it depends on what you're studying equation. They need to be able to do both. It just depends on what equations you're studying at the same time.
Yeah.
And I think the same thing holds true with most of these, 2, 3, and 4. It really depends on what you're studying at the time. Okay, so those are important all the way through because just my background knowledge on what the kids have been doing when they represent constraints, they're horrible at that. To be able to put constraints on top of it, really don't get that. And so I think that's really important, beginning as early on as we possibly can, appropriate for what equations and functions we're trying to use. So that's to me, and I think it pops up later when it talks about appropriate domains and ranges, another big thing that we need to really look at. These kids are not, and I'm sure Beverly and Bob can both attest to that when they get to college. Domains, ranges, what's appropriate, constraints.
Yeah,
really
I think that's
them.
Just a hard, and I don't know if I understand why. I feel like I'm smart and I feel like I'm a good teacher, but that, why kids find that hard, it remains mysterious to me.
It doesn't seem as hard to me when you're in context.
Mm-hmm. No, that's right.
That's
if you do it then,
right?
Mm-hmm.
That's right. In context, of course. Well, and I think it goes back to how kids have difficulty in elementary school along division when they're doing division and interpreting the remainders. What does the remainder mean? Does it mean I round up? Does it mean it's that part or do I round down? What does it mean? Mm-hmm. And it depends on the context that it's in. So I think most of those, with anything that, how we would phrase it, it would just depend upon what functions they were studying at the time.
I'm playing with the idea of including solving equations, solving inequalities. One very well, of course, that we talked about some before that is something we can do even before high school or even before Algebra 1. But the here you've got your solving quadratic equations and then your systems of equations and where it comes down to five, I don't know, you know, I'm trying to jump completely ahead, but, you know, it says prove that, given the system of two equations, two variables, replacing one by the sum of the other, blah, 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 and, I mean, I get it, but, you know, prove, I don't even know, I know, what, I mean, I guess you just start talking about your golden rule of algebra or something, you know, like that, but, I mean, I don't know where that comes in, I mean, that they're trying to say all kids have to do, you know, substitution or, sorry, solving by addition or elimination, whatever you want to call it, I guess, fine, I know a lot of teachers do skip that, and I think that's okay too, so, I feel like that's a little unnecessary, and I don't understand.
Yeah, I'm not sure if prove is necessary.
I don't think so either, I just think that was.
Sorry, I was busy emailing the other group because the time is upon us, and I missed the very beginning of what you said.
Julie, is that just the elimination method there?
Well, that's pretty much what it's talking about.
Yeah.
That's a proof part, I mean, I think we'll have an issue with that.
For number five.
Yeah, they're just describing the elimination.
Yeah, but I think it says.
But so you prove it by putting in variable coefficients, or?
Yeah, but I mean, it's really about students proving.
Yeah, I understand that.
But I mean.
But yeah, unneeded.
Yeah, I guess I'm looking at it, and I'm just wondering, you know, what kind of rigor are we talking about here?
Yeah.
And if it's not much, then, I mean, I guess I get it, but.
I'm thinking they want us to have 365 days in a year.
Right.
I think that's a.
In a school year.
Students can understand.
That it makes sense.
Again, there's really nice context for doing that. I mean, there's nice contextual ways of showing that, you know, you can replace this with this, you know, the prices.
And I think that's what it is, I think it's more contextual than a formal.
Right, I think that's what they mean, but we need to make.
But so, yeah, so let's say that, because when I look at it, I think to myself, you know, are you kidding me? I mean, and I don't mean to be cheeky, I just mean, you know, please tell me what I'm supposed to do.
Right.
Yeah.
I'm like you, when I read the proofs, I'm thinking.
Yeah.
Yeah, does it.
And it's really an understanding.
Right.
Because really, when you do that contextually, you're not proving that you're examining it.
Right.
Well, yeah, or you could say it's a proof by induction or something like that, but yeah.
So I think that the proof is not, I mean, putting in context or understanding the system of two equations, if that's important. But the actual rigorous proof.
Are we waiting for them to come in here and meet us, or are we going?
We've got 20 minutes to go. I think it's 11, so we'll get back on this.
What do you guys think of 4A?
I mean, I think that's great, but I think that's algebra two. Is that what you mean, complete the square and derive the quadratic formula?
No, I was looking at the specific form that they give there.
Oh.
Yeah. Because I took the time to do that, and it was not simple. And I'm thinking, why would you want to do that? I mean, I understand why you would want to complete the square for various applications to graph and that, and why you would need the quadratic formula for various applications, but why on earth would you need to go from that form to the quadratic formula?
Well, that is complete the square, isn't it?
Right.
I mean, that's what the form you get it into.
No, they're wanting you to go from the form where the square is completed.
Well, that's what
you. To proving the quadratic formula.
No, it says transform any quadratic equation into that form, which is complete the square.
Right.
That is complete the square.
And then derive the quadratic.
Use that to derive the quadratic. I mean, how else do you derive the quadratic formula?
Well,
what you end up with, though, is x squared minus 2px plus p squared minus q equals 0.
Yeah, I don't think they're saying letters. No.
That's what this says.
Yeah, you know what, Lisa, I think I see it. So it says derive the quadratic formula from this form. What it should say is derive the quadratic formula from this process. Or something like that.
I don't think they mean
I think Bob and I both did the same thing.
There we go.
We saw what it was supposed to mean, corrected it in our own heads, and didn't think about it anymore.
That I understand.
Yeah.
Yeah, P and Q equal things related to A.
Right,
and C. Yeah.
Good point, though, because
it's working.
I think Bob and I did the same thing. We knew what it meant.
Well, yeah, I mean, that's kind of the way I approach it.
Well, you thought you knew what it meant.
I
read it literally.
X minus a number squared equals a number.
Yeah.
That's the concept. I don't talk about A, B, and C at first.
I don't either.
So the A, B, and C comes when you do, when you generalize it to the
Right.
formula. So I mean, I think this is the way I think of it.
Obviously we need to clarify.
Yeah, there needs to be a.
People will read it that way, and I'll respect that.
Put that in there real easy.
Yeah.
That's why we can't have just you two alone.
Well, and again, that's probably something I looked at this one, but if you look at the progressions, it probably shows that whole thing.
Yeah.
But it ought to be, I mean, we can put it here.
It needs to be clear. It's just not clear.
So, but I know, so we do, so now this is the same, completing the square is for algebra one, but also the derivation of the quadratic formula is algebra one.
Yeah, that's what we talked about last time, that kind of culminates that quadratic.
It is of it, yeah.
I like it where they go together, but I don't know, when you go through that derivation, there's a lot of rational expressioning it up in there.
That's true.
Yes, there is. A good fraction review.
I'm just thinking of algebra one students, though.
I used to teach this 20 years ago in our algebra class that was split into 2 years. We had a part A and a part B. And that part B class, we derived the quadratic formula.
I mean, if the algebra one teachers think they can handle it, then I am.
I don't want to add anything.
And Tiffany, I want to get your input because you teach middle school. And the algebra one will be in middle school as well as high school.
I have not ever done that, but I'm not saying that we can't. I kind of, having not tried it, I think it's possible, but do I know for sure it'll work now? And having not tried it, I can't say that it won't work.
I taught it in middle school, algebra one, I'm guessing 27 years. Mm-hmm. It works. Those kids actually catch on better than the, because
I'm
almost done. Because they're kind of advanced in their abstract thinking, and it's an abstract concept. It's not something they're touching and manipulating.
Right.
You know, so. The Algebra 1 at 8th grade is easier, and I also taught it at Algebra 1 high school level. And they can all get it. Yeah, you have to put some thought into it. You have to do it sequentially. And you have to connect it to a problem they've already done.
And I think this is where we had talked about helping teachers. You know, we talked about with professional development that we obviously we don't have a say in that, but I think we have a lot of teachers that don't understand how to derive. The quadratic formula.
So basically, are you showing them or demonstrating it, or do you want the students to do that?
No, not demonstrate it. I don't know that I had students.
Yeah, and that's the next question.
Yeah.
Do we demonstrate it, or is this something they can be tested on?
Because I don't know that the kids can be able to do that.
They can. I put it on assessment.
Like the kind of development I would do would be like starting with their part B here, where you start with something that's a perfect square. Mm-hmm. And then move to something like x minus 3 quantity squared equals 49, and move to that. Mm-hmm. And then, like Bob said, put it in its standard form. Mm-hmm. And then go through the process from standard form of completing that square again. What would you have to do? Mm-hmm. And with concrete numbers, you know, right. For the coefficient. Okay. Whole numbers. Which
I think we could probably do it. I mean, do we want to give them a really scary function? No, but I think they could probably.
Maybe do we limit it to? I started to say limit it to where A is one, but
no.
I don't even know if that's then you can't even do it. Yeah.
No. When my success I felt was of course you start with those that have
right.
even numbered linear coefficients and. Mm-hmm. And they can make those nice, you know, divide it in two and then square. And then you give them some with odd, and then you give them some positive, you give them some negative that are numbers, integers. Then maybe try a fraction.
That's daring.
Okay?
Yeah.
But you have a lot of exposure to those things before you have them do it in a general form.
And then for you, and prior to that, you have to, if I give you x squared plus 3x, what number would I have to add on to make it a perfect square triangle? So a lot of work would have to be done with that beforehand, so by the time you do that, then they would have some understanding of those concepts, but it would take a while. And I think part of it goes back to making sure that teachers understand that. I don't think, I mean, that would just be professional development within the districts and within the state to help teachers at that level, to make sure they understand it, not just hand, because I think the one thing we don't want to do, we've seen, is just handing kids quadratic formula and then they don't understand any of the parts, how to use it, how to apply it, so we really want them to understand the components, not just use it.
And I think it all ties into the graphing that you factor to get the roots, that you complete the square to find the number of times that you, you know, that it's, all that, I see that all as a piece if you're studying quadratic functions.
I agree.
So.
Had a student tell me what's the quadratic formula, I had ax squared plus b, it's a squared plus b squared equals c squared. Talk about not understanding formulas, right? It's a right, it's a good formula, it's a good right.
For the pieces, safely used.
So are you saying it is appropriate though in algebra one?
I think we all agree.
I think it is, yeah.
Okay. And when we talk about B, the second part of that, which is recognize the quadratic formula gives complex solutions. While algebra one kids, we will not have delved much into complex numbers. That would definitely be, I mean, they need to know that. They'll get real and non-real solutions.
Same thing, Kathy.
When it talks about quadratic formula gives complex solutions and write them as A plus BI, I'm not sure that would be in algebra one, because we really haven't talked about complex numbers in algebra one, imaginary numbers.
So really non-real solutions.
So would you give them ones that have non-real, or just not even give them to them at all, and I just would not talk about it? Or you would just pick, you know, is the square root of negative 37 just no? Or does it have any other?
Non-real.
Well, if you do it in a graphing situation, it doesn't have any.
There's no root.
Right.
So roots are non-roots. I mean, I think we can go there.
No real roots.
But I would not go, that would be the A plus B, I would probably be in algebra two.
Okay. Yeah. So I guess that's what I'm saying. So then you, if you were doing quadratic formula, you'd just stop? Or you wouldn't get,
you would choose your problems carefully.
Okay. There you go.
But when you get to like number 10 down here of representing it as a graph, you could do it as a graph and talk about fact that there are no real numbers that are, you know, so it doesn't have any x-intercepts.
So you look at the graph first and then say what would happen if you put this in there. It doesn't factor, obviously, so,
I would have a discussion with kids in algebra one completely that says, you know, you started out talking about counting numbers in elementary school, and then we were whole numbers, and we worked our way up to fractions and decimals, and then we talked about integers, and we're at a point now where the numbers we talk about are called real numbers. Mm-hmm. There are some numbers that you're going to talk about in the future,
right?
And you can talk about those non-real numbers and imaginary numbers and say, we're not going to go into depth in here, but I want you to understand that when it comes out with that, that's something that you're going to have to carry this concept to the next level. So telling them that they exist, but not going in depth and exploring them, I think is completely appropriate in algebra one.
I agree.
I think so too, because I always wanted to take back when you were a very young child, if I said it was 5 take away 7, you said you couldn't do that.
Right.
Yeah, so you had things until you learned more about math.
Right. I think the one thing that we just want to make sure is that teachers don't make the kids have to find the complex.
Right.
Is that they exist. And the imaginary numbers, you have the real and the complex system that exist, but we, so the wording up there is what I would be concerned about, is that teachers think they have to teach all the system of complex numbers. And we don't want them to do, but I totally agree with that.
I was just going to say, hopefully the Department of Education will have some guidance for teachers along these lines of examples and things, and I think being consistent with the language from the get-go would be very good on that. You know, when we say real and non-real, we might put in parentheses complex with A plus BI or however, you know, to try to encourage the teachers to feel comfortable with that too.
My note says introduce Algebra 1, but explore Algebra 2. Is that what you meant?
I think, yeah. Yes, I did.
Deborah?
I think one important component that's often screwed up in textbooks is using an appropriate method. Because systems are solving quadratics. It's always going to say, you know, solve it completely the square, and I could look at it factor.
Exactly.
I mean, I think that's really something that's important that Audrey emphasized, that being able to analyze a problem and see what the approach is.
Yeah, and it shouldn't be that it's so prescriptive that you have to do it this way.
Right. I mean, even having some that you just classified and didn't necessarily solve, but just talked about what method to use.
Yeah, I think that 4B, I think, talks about solving them by inspection sometimes.
Right.
And x squared equals 49, you don't need to use a quadratic formula.
Yeah, right. It's just 7, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, right. In this other group.
Well, and I just would add to what Lisa said a minute ago, I think with all due respect to the Department of Education, I think that we need to take it upon ourselves to write using clear language, and so that we are giving, and everybody knows that I don't want these to be prescriptive and telling teachers exactly what to do. We don't have that conversation. But, you know,
I was just indicating that I think there's a role for Desi to play in developing and sharing, you know, products with the teachers.
Practices. And eventually, yeah, I would hope that would be the case. But I feel like we need to leave our stuff, you know, unambiguous. And I agree with Beverly, and this is how I do it when I teach, that, you know, kids do need to have, you know, an appreciation or understanding for, you know, when a method might be appropriate, like using the square root method if you B is zero or if there's no x term or whatever, you know, that those are the kind of things, you know, as a teaching tool, you know, that I would hope that my children's teachers do, you know, and so that we have that
right.
Appreciating. In fact, that's what my kids are doing today, is working on comparing, and they have to do the graphs and all this stuff too, and they do have complex solutions, but they're doing a comparison of all that stuff for solving quadratics, and so I think that's what they get for asking me to just give them one method for doing something.
Yeah,
I'm
yeah,
back
yeah,
with
yeah.
that compared assignment.
I like what you're saying, because the groups, whoever Desi or someone would bring in, if they do bring someone in, need to know what our intent was.
Exactly.
And that's and
every makes their work easier.
Right. And so that
sure.
you know, so that we're not left thinking, wait, that's not what it was at all.
Yeah.
And so again, I just wanted to offer that up as a question.
Yeah, I agree. And I think we already talked about 5. That we talked about understanding not necessarily true, put it in context. On number 6, didn't we talk about this last time? Solve systems of linear equations exactly and approximately.
There we go.
What does that mean, approximately?
Right. Look at graphs. When you look at graphs, it's not an exact. So you can never tell because your graph is not necessarily an exact. So approximately would be mostly through a graphing approach. Equations would be an exact.
Why would you even use that? The graph?
I'm sorry to go over this again.
Well, I think to solve the system, a lot of times you want kids to look at it and tell what's an approximate flow
okay.
where these two.
Okay.
Yeah, so.
And you can track what you think it is.
Yeah.
You can plug it back in to determine.
Yeah.
But I mean, that is always a conversation that you have. You know, that unless you are like Little Miss, super careful with your graphing and your pencil is super sharp and lucky that you have, you know, a pretty normal number of answer, you know, it is an approximation.
And if it's an integer value, good likely to catch it, but it's not energy value anymore. We talked about really 6 and 7 the last time, but I think the discussion that we had, because it was someplace else, but what we talked about here is only using, I believe David used the term functions, quadratic functions, because they haven't studied circles yet, they haven't studied anything that they really haven't studied at that point. I've studied parabolas, but anything at that point we have not studied. So, because this leaves it wide open to go to ellipsis, hyperbolas, and
mm-hmm.
something they haven't even seen. So we had that discussion last time that it would be functions, okay? So that we would do quadratic functions.
So you're taking out circles, or?
Mm-hmm. Circles in Algebra 1. In Algebra 2, they can be put back in. But in Algebra 1, we've talked about functions, just because they haven't, they don't even know what the equation of a circle is, so they kind of would be difficult for them to do that, so.
You could fix that by putting the word univariant right in front of quadratic. I don't know how clear that is.
Wait, that's being word what?
Univariant.
Quadratic equation.
That'll make it clear to the teachers too.
Yeah.
Thank you, Julie.
Yeah.
I could not
have
clear language.
Well, you can
Change it to.
This is how the cover of the cardinals.
I can just remember when we said, when something came out and said, you were very negative last time, how much time it took to explain what that was. So I want to agree with you, say, we'll just, yeah, we can work on the wording of that, but I think we had that discussion before. And then in algebra two, we want to still continue to solve systems, but now we can do quadratic to quadratic, and we can take a lot of those parameters off that we didn't have before, so. Okay. 8 and 9. Those are plus.
Yeah, so then we're going to keep them plus.
Yeah, we did. And it's not something that, I mean, it's something that, that I teach in algebra two, yes, but it's not necessarily, I think we talked about that every child.
Right.
When they graduate, your kids, and if you choose to teach it, you go for it, okay? That's absolutely up to you, but we had talked about that those types of things we agreed with and really should be in another document that says these are kids going into science and engineering careers, so that that would be their pathway.
Why do you think major season vectors obviously will make a list of, you know, things that should be in that, you know, fourth year or whatever. I know I will never forget one year when I gave a group of, and these were not honors kids, something that they had to do for part of their final exam was to give a lesson, and I let them choose anything. And like half the class chose major season. One of the things they had to talk about was why they chose what they chose.
Right.
And I still remember this kid who was like a nice kid, not a very, you know, good student, so to speak. And he just said, well, I picked this because it's just so easy. I mean, it's just, so, but with that said, you know, I'm fine leaving it until later because if you get very in depth with it, then it isn't quite so easy.
Well, on 8 and 9, are you talking about taking those out for algebra one or for both algebra one and two?
Well, the first standard was for the ones that were for science and engineering that not all students would be able to.
Okay, I'm talking about algebra one and algebra two.
That's what we're talking about too.
Well, I think the algebra 2 should have major C's in there. I've already at least 2x2 major C's as they apply to solving systems of linear equations. I think that would be a very appropriate introduction for them, the major C's. But if you've already cashed that out last time, I'll just leave that on the table.
How would you know if a child is
What we're saying, I think, with these bus standards is that when we go to courses beyond algebra 2, that whether a district calls it pre-calc or they call it algebra 3 or they call it
math analysis,
that those are types of things that we can have in those courses. So the kids that are really interested in that math, science, course, that's appropriate for them, but is it necessary for a music major to know that?
Well, why, then I guess, and you guys are obviously the experts, but then why are they listed with algebra?
Well, that's algebra for the whole high school.
That's K-through
conceptual,
right.
K-through, I'm sorry.
No,
well, it's algebra through high school.
But my comment goes along with, but what I'm saying goes along with what you're saying is I don't want to see any doors closed, and I'm not saying that that would close a door, that one particular topic, it's just one thing, but I think that it would be easily, easy to keep in algebra 2, especially since they've already been introduced to solving systems in algebra 1.
And I think that, you know, what we said, part of what we talked about last time is if I taught algebra 2, would I probably still include it? Yes. It would not be probably something, when you look at this, this is going to, you know what we write is going to be assessed. And so I'm not sure that how, you know, assessing matrices and solving by matrices on a test would be something that we would want to do. It's a strategy for teaching, a way of teaching.
I think it's on the ACT if you look at their...
If you would teach it in your algebra 2 class, why wouldn't... Why shouldn't everyone in Missouri teach it in their algebra 2 class?
Well, I teach conic sections too, and not everybody would teach conic sections. Yeah. So part of that section. conic sections we're talking about.
Circles.
Circles of ellipses, hyperboles, doing some different things, so. And part of this, we were talking about the kids that would graduate from high school and go directly in, not into college necessarily, but the kids that are going to go into the technical schools or the workforce afterwards, what is appropriate for every kid through Algebra 2 to be able to do. And is matrices is something that you could teach?
Yeah, I mean, you could. I guess I would, I mean, to address, you know, Deborah's question, which I think is also part of Lisa's point, you know, to, you know, Algebra 2 is not the end of the road. I mean, just to get into Mizzou, you've got to have one course beyond that, for sure. So nobody is stopping there. Now, to get into some of the, you know, smaller schools and things like that, you know, yes, you can, you know, or if it's open admission, of course you can. But, you know, so far as, you know, college bound, you know, college readiness, you know, that fourth course is something that exists. Now, as far as, you know, could you include matrices in Algebra 2? I mean, you could, and it would be okay, for sure, if you limited it to 2x2s maybe, or, you know, something like that. I mean, we did that for a long time in Algebra 2.
Is it on the ACT?
The only thing I believe that's on there is this, now that it may be changed.
The only thing that's on the ACT that would be at an entry level would be add two matrices together.
Which is super easy.
Right, and it's not solving equations using matrices. So that's the difference there, so.
And it is put, the plus sign does mean in the fourth course, you know, the way that they're set up, which I also think is not always clear the way it's written, but I'm at this point, I think we all know.
I think we can rearrange.
Yeah, so, yeah, no, but I just meant, so then it probably isn't.
There's a chair here. There's a chair here.
Okay, so I think, because that was good discussion, and Lisa will bring that back, so when we come back, after our discussion here, we'll try to finish up representing solve equations and inequalities graphically. I don't think that should take us too long to do.
Yeah, and just super quick, the thing I forgot to say is that, you know, for something like that, if we want to do that, you know, too, I think we have an option to do, which is what you guys did in your learning goals, to put a, you know, a designation of locally assessed.
Right.
And I think that would address that as well, so.
But they can do that, put it in locally assessed issues.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that was, because it's difficult sometimes to really, it's kind of like the ACT test would say, they solve equations. On a multiple choice test, they don't solve equations, they substitute a number into the equation to figure out.
Yeah, but
it's kind of given, yeah. So. Okay. So, welcome, K-5 group. We're so glad you've come down to join us. So tell me, I think part of what you guys tell us what you wanted to do was talk about the structure and what you guys have put together so far. Is that correct?
Yes. Okay. And we put it in the Dropbox, so it's been there since our last meeting.
Right.
For fifth grade standards, but we were wanting to know, because you had worked on middle school last time, correct? So to see fifth grade to sixth grade or sixth grade to fifth grade.
To see that.
Try to get continuity on not just the structure, but also some of the content.
Okay. So those of you that maybe have not pulled that up. Should be on KC5 worker notes, and there are a couple of them there names. So there's like fifth grade strands and domains,
academic standards.
It's the academic standards. Strands and domains are all rough drafts.
One of the things I noticed in your academic standards is the inclusion of data and statistics, and specifically the one about describing a data set using concepts of mean, median, mode, blah, 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 blah. We've included that in sixth grade.
So it would be sixth grade.
We have that in sixth grade. We felt that
we're making it over
it.
There's two. The October 3rd.
Well, I think it says fifth grade academic standards. There's an October 2nd and an October 3rd one, but I think it says specifically fifth grade academic standards. Is that what's the one that's supposed to be in?
Does it have the input output chart on it?
Yes, it does. Mm-hmm.
That's probably in a highlighted part on
yes,
it.
Right.
That's probably the one. That's the one that we, that's our rough draft. Yes.
Okay.
And that input output is just purely just a visual. That's not what we're going. That's not the one we're actually going to be using.
there's no really a, that's just an idea of what we're going to have.
So that is the document that we're supposed to be looking at right now?
Yes.
Just make sure.
What kind of graphs are you doing in the sixth grade?
We added circle, I'll tell you that.
But no, like, we have line graph, it's a fifth grade, I didn't know. That's the only other standard we have under display, analyze and interpret data right now. Create and interpret a line graph to represent.
So we talked about.
I mean, line graphs are all through.
Box plots and histograms, right?
For sixth grade or for seventh grade?
Sixth grade.
Sixth grade and box plots and histograms.
And, yep.
Dot plots, histograms, box plots.
Sixth grade.
Yep.
In fact, pretty well, we said that what we liked, the organization of and everything, were in the Common Core standards opposed to Massachusetts. We liked what was in there, and we pretty well said that that was what we wanted to see on that, that we felt that it was appropriate for middle school. We liked the organization of statistics and probability, how you learn to gather information and how to summarize it in sixth grade. And so we're displaying it. And in the sixth grade and seventh grade is when we moved more into the probability and the sampling investigations that way. And then we liked that in eighth grade we went to bivariate and we went back to those things. So we liked the organization and structure of content of that as a whole.
For that.
So that would be important to know if sixth grade is going to be doing the dot plots and box plots, that we probably want to keep some of the line plot work in at third and fourth grades, so that, that would build to that. So that's it, we get to know too.
What about that? We have described a data set using the concepts of median, mean, mode, maximum, minimum, and range. We have talked to sixth grade on that.
Right. They just, they would be testing, or they'd have that standard in sixth grade. Because that's the foundation piece for your histograms, too.
But we do mean, median, and mode. At some point, that does come up. Maybe not.
Yeah, I think you'd want to introduce those concepts at least in fifth grade. I mean,
I would not do that. I would do measures of center and measures of variability in the sixth grade. I think that that is much more appropriate for the child than having done middle school for too many years. Not too many.
What did she just say? Explain the difference between that?
Between what?
Measures of center and measures of variability.
Sure, when you're measuring the center, those are things like mean. You know, you're seeing where the middle ground is. It's a measure there.
Average.
You can talk about the median.
Yes.
The median, what's in the middle there.
Right.
Variability talks about how far apart or what the spread is, more like the range or the interquartile range or the
mean absolute
deviation, but things like that that are talking about how far apart the numbers are as opposed to where the middle is, and giving kids different views of those. So one is measures of center, and one's measures of variability, or how wide they are. Those are concepts that are best left to sixth grade and middle school, in my opinion.
So what about histograms, then? Where do you foresee?
It's in sixth grade.
So if histogram is in sixth grade, that to me would make sense on in fifth grade, spending more time on those measures of center.
I'm sorry, say it again.
I was just trying to think of what, like, the prerequisite skills that a student might need in carrying forward, and if histogram is going to occur in sixth grade, because histogram, you have your intervals, and you think of the pocket, like the buckets, like grouping the numbers together, so you kind of have to know your range in order to come up with those intervals for that seventh grade or sixth grade histogram. So to me, a prerequisite would be some of that scaling and grouping and thinking of the median, what's your median, and knowing what your range is so you can have those ideas, developing those ideas. No?
Not for me, Marilyn.
Well, you could, but I mean, you could also do it all in sixth grade. I mean, you could do median and then later do this.
It just seems to me like a good group,
nice
a good thing that
reason to show why you
the reason of why we're doing this.
Why we look at median, yeah.
And if you put it on your line plots in fifth grade, as it suggests, interpreting a line plot, then I think it starts to lay that foundation.
Well, I think line plot is actually younger than third grade, or fifth grade.
It is, but it's, again, reemphasized with fractional increments. So, I mean, we're coming back to that.
What about?
I was just going to say, the overarching idea here is that measures of center happen at the same time, or in the same grade as variability, because variability, measures of center are important because of variability. And so, I mean, that's the philosophy of it. You could certainly spread it all out. But I think the philosophy of this, I mean, I like it better than it's, you see why you need center because you talk about variability. So.
Well, in the fifth grade, did you have anything on finding the average of a set of numbers? I think a conceptual thing that could be done would be like giving them different sets of numbers where, you know, the average, I mean, it's easy to see that the average, the mean, is a good representation overall, and some that maybe where it's not so helpful, you know.
I don't know if they really understand it in fifth grade, because my seventh graders struggle with it a lot of times when we say, mean or median, because that's a representation of this data and why. Some of them pick it up, but if we're talking every student, I'm not sure that's developmentally appropriate for them.
Maybe the goal is to not do as many things and really focus on fewer things, and if sixth grade is going to give a really big focus to measures of center and measures of variability, rather than doing a little bit here, and I understand about setting the precursor, what you're talking about, the prerequisite information.
But it wouldn't have to be a standard either. Like, we wouldn't have it as a listed standard. I was trying to think of what would fall under our data and statistics at this point.
I was surprised that you had it, to be honest with you.
Yeah, it really should probably wait until sixth grade.
It's a middle school concept. It's a middle school, it's developed, development is ready for it, it fits there, and it's cohesive. And it makes sense to discuss those things all at once. So I was a little surprised you guys were doing it.
And the other thing to remember, too, is when it's there, that's what's going to be assessed. Does it keep anybody from developing some of those concepts within their district if they choose to? No, but do you really want that assessed until the kids really fully understand what they're doing? Does it mean that District X, they can introduce it if they want to? Nothing is going to say that people
No, I was just going to say, you know, like, in the question that came up, you know, is like, which measure of central tendency is a better representation of that? You know, just speaking for myself personally, I find that the answers to those questions to be, you know, often fairly debatable at best. And so to ask a fifth grader, or even really, I mean, it's a conversation in middle school, but as far as is something that you can have a definitive answer, which you need if you're going to be doing testing, you know, I think that's a little much. So
the difference between asking what's the best measures used and being able to find a mean.
Yeah, I don't disagree with that. I mean, I'm just saying I know that came up, you know, the issue of, you know, like, which one is the best. I would really reserve that, you know, now, like, as far as how you calculate it. I will stay agnostic on that.
Okay. Two, we have to, you know, there's give with anything. And so if we take time in fifth grade to teach that, then we're taking it away from other things, which I get too. But I would much rather, as a middle school teacher, see the emphasis put on, like, fractions and decimals in fifth grade and spend that time doing that, so that when we do measures of center, I can use fractions and decimals without having to go back and teach them operations on fractions and decimals in seventh grade. Again, because they didn't really truly understand it. I mean, that's a personal preference, I guess, but I just, I I'm afraid if we put too much stuff in there and if it's going to be just a real short, here it is, go with it anyway, I would rather see it more in depth in another grade and let those teachers focus on something else.
We really did
and not
try.
Not just a piece of it, but the whole.
We tried very hard. Now, we're much further along middle school than our high school because we're in the middle of that. But with middle school, we tried really hard to keep the philosophy of less standards, more depth. So that's part of why we like all the data probabilities introduction there because it's really in depth and it's hit hard there as opposed to cutting it into little pieces and spreading it out over a lot of grade levels where you end up reviewing it over and over and over again. So that's kind of was our philosophy that we tried to stick to there as much as possible.
Another thing we wanted to touch base with you about was about finishing up fractions. Right now we have adding, subtracting, and multiplying completed in fifth grade, but with division we only have whole numbers by fractions. I'm wondering where you all stood on that with sixth grade.
We are going to complete division of fractions.
We'll take the baton.
And we're taking the baton in sixth grade.
Got it. We may drop it, Marilyn,
but we've got it.
And then high school will pick it up again. Because we know you're going to have such a solid foundation of addition, subtraction, multiplication, and K through five. That
that's very appropriate to add.
What about the geometry? We brought in three-dimensional.
I was going to ask.
Classifying two-dimensional, three-dimensional. What do you think about that? Or what is?
I was wondering if because of the emphasis on volume, if you were tying those together.
Yeah, that's why we're
bringing it back.
I mean, if we're talking about volume, we should probably also talk about three-dimensional shapes.
Yeah,
I think that would be wonderful, personally.
Well, and for multiplying fractions, I think that is doable.
On three-dimensional shapes.
Oh, well,
we're
thinking
volume.
Well,
we're dealing with volume. You're talking about fractional size.
Yes.
Okay. When you say rectangular solids, are you saying prisms?
Yes.
Well, prisms.
We've had prisms there.
I think the discussion was that it might be an irregular, it might be an irregular shape of the box, not just a rectangle, but yes. I mean, we're saying that, but it was.
You know what? I really do want to know what you're saying because if you're saying a rectangular solids, we usually refer to the solids by the shape of their base. Mm-hmm. So you are not talking about pyramids?
Right, no.
So you're talking about prisms?
So we should keep it prisms.
Yes.
That's
what we're talking about.
Okay, and
triangle.
But I think we're also saying that it might not have a, maybe we don't need rectangular there, but it might not have a rectangle base, right? It might have a shape that's not, that has like a rectangle and then a square on top of it or something. And so figuring out how you
will plan that.
I get that, but I personally, this is just me, think that's inappropriate for K through 5.
Unless you're talking about dividing it up into two
and then compositions, and then those are usually found in middle school.
Yeah, so
you have to have a solid foundation on the solids on the rectangular prism before it can put those together or take those apart. Because taking them apart or dividing them isn't just about, there's different types of learners in the world. And those types of learners have to know how to visualize that and be able to separate those and break those apart into all rectangular pieces. And if they're not able to do that, and a lot of fifth graders, even some sixth graders, are not able to do that, they need the most basic solid foundation in fifth grade of rectangular prisms. And if they can get the rectangular prisms down, and then we can move into compositions of those in middle school, then you are going to build a more solid foundation for them to progress through them. It's just jumping too much. I think those of us in this room may be able to do that. But when you're talking about the kids that I've seen and had over all those decades, that's kind of unrealistic for them to be able to do that.
And I'm just going to say, and if anybody else can add to this, I taught 380 calculus, and my kids had difficulty with those shapes, and I really feel are composing, decomposing, and I think it's because we try to do too many different things in here. If we have a really good foundation to make sure they really understand this concept very solidly, then when you move on to the next, it makes it much easier to compose, because my kids in the calculus had trouble composing and decomposing. I don't know about
Community college students have no trouble with that.
Right.
Well, how do you guys feel about rectangular right prisms, finding the volumes of those, but finding the surface area of other right prisms? Because aren't they also doing area and volume at the same time then?
No, here?
Not in the fifth grade.
Okay.
So if we changed it to just prisms on that, if you look above where it says classify two and three dimensional shapes, and the third bullet, relate two dimensional shapes to three dimensional shapes, analyze the properties of polyhedral solids, describing their number of edges, faces, vertices. Is that appropriate for fifth grade, or would that be more of the middle school too, with the faces, edges, vertices?
I don't know what you mean by relate two-dimensional shapes to three-dimensional shapes.
The fact that a rectangular prism is composed of so many faces. Rectangles, the faces are rectangles.
Okay.
And this net can be folded into...
So you're talking about nets and those types of things. Is that what you're talking about?
Okay. And recognizing the polygon within the polyhedron, basically, the face.
And so you said change what word?
That was a new, like, this is a different one that we kind of put together a bunch of ideas. So I wanted to make sure that was appropriate for fifth grade, and that sixth grade's not, doesn't have that. And
hey, you know, and I just, oh my gosh, we don't have a draft of anything, so just recognize, I just want to admit that. One of the guiding principles that we talked about is, two things. So one that, it needs to be crystal clear, we're thinking of those, beginning teachers in small districts or country schools and making sure they know exactly, what they're meant to do. And then the second piece is, whatever you put in there is going to be on the test. So, make sure that you're not setting yourself up for a test that, kids are not ready for. So if there are limitations, to make them explicit. Is that, and so again, with the admission that we've written nothing to offer those suggestions.
And while we haven't written nothing, we have those ideas about being explicit when we say this. We've written some notes. This is what we mean, like solving systems of linear equations and quadratic equations. We've been very specific about how far we're going to go with that in Algebra 1 and then in Algebra 2. James, so if we were trying, because otherwise, if it's not clear, the teachers are going to find, how far am I supposed to take this? So we want to make a document as clear as possible for teachers to understand.
I know you've
probably
seen your notes. Did we say nets will stay in fifth, or did we think that it should be title?
We have nets, yes.
But did we talk about classifying by faces? I don't remember ever talking about that.
I think we typed nets to surface area.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
appropriate.
Right.
Well, you need it.
So was perimeter an area in fourth grade?
Yeah, I think it is.
Yeah.
Well, perimeter is actually third grade.
Yeah. It's linear measurement.
Linear measurement.
But I guess hearing what you said about the classification, we ever talked about that. I don't know.
I don't recall that either, in and of itself. I just wonder here, where the question was asked, what does this mean, relate two-dimensional shapes to three-dimensional shapes? And so, just playing with that myself, and trying to be like super explicit, you know, recognize two-dimensional shapes as the surfaces, you know, of a three-dimensional shape, something like that, you know, and I don't, that, I'm not saying that that's like perfect language by any means, but just something, trying to make that, like, you know, super clear so that you're not setting your teachers up to think, and then, you know, and then what happens, and everybody knows my little stories, but, you know, then teachers look in books and they see these sort of propagating methods and
projections
and
isometrics,
right?
I don't see anything detrimental by you classifying before we look at.
No,
that's fine.
Yeah, classifying, I think that's the level four. In my experience, classifying happens for polyhedrals.
Yes.
Rectangular prisms.
And I work the heck out of them.
Yeah, I just really make sure.
The whole numbers.
So we all do composition and we can put it in fractions.
Well, no, well, we're doing the fractions, I think, we're keeping those for sixth grade. If it's just rectangular prisms that are next to each other, I'm not real bothersome about that, but we can't have a shape that we're dividing into different parts too much.
Yeah, first of all, you've got to have those faces match up perfectly, but, well, I mean, I guess you wouldn't necessarily, but that would just be so creepy. But yeah, if you had two, I know. I mean,
he's that exotic. Where is Jerry?
There you go, we're getting there now.
And I do think, you know, what David said, you know, that maybe, you know, you have these kind of things as a context for doing these problems. Maybe that puts a little bit of interest in it for the kids. Does that make sense? So, I mean, you know, if you're using it that way, but I just wanted to put those cautions.
Yeah. And as far as context goes, throughout third, fourth, fifth, with perimeter, area, volume, I would really like to see units displayed on all the standards. Mm-hmm. Or at least, if not units, then at least some measurement activities or something going on there.
You're talking cubic units, is that what you're saying?
Or square units.
You're just saying
square inches.
Linear to, yes. To quadratic.
Yeah.
To,
yeah,
so that they understand
that these are units and what
that, so that they, it's clear that they're not just numbers. These
right.
numbers stand
yes.
for different types
yes.
of quantities.
And I think yes. they have a really difficult, I think if they could come in knowing the difference between what a cubic unit is and what a square unit is, that's huge. And a linear unit. You know, because that's, I mean, all the way through, was mine, doing all the tests in calculus, is units of measure, what is it, cubic, you know, when we're using cubic units, when we're using square units, when we're using linear units, that's just really huge for kids.
Yeah,
it is.
And so, just
jump in. Oh, I know, yeah.
All right.
But they don't understand that.
I don't know what level it would be, but just I just know at the college, the first lab I did with a physical science class, they had some objects, we were talking about density, and real density. So I was giving some thought before because my boss, you know, likes to come and observe my class all the time. So the first class, they had actual, I feel like there's a yellow line, a blue line, a green line. They measured the dimensions in centimeters and they didn't know which side of the ruler to use. That's another matter.
Yeah,
that's right. But somehow in volunteering, I went through 12 gross rulers. So there's a lot of kids that do know how to measure in elementary school. But, anyway, so they had to measure the green, measure the red, measure the blue, and compute the volume. The next class, it said, you know, measure length, width, and height of the rectangulars. And then the last one was measure dimensions. And they had trouble with the first group, was just measuring the red, yellow, and the blue one, and trying to get the volume. So I don't know what level it would be to have students just bring them in or have them there, where you're using the rulers, you're using the centimeters, you're using the inches, you're measuring, you know, putting it somewhere where you can relate the measurements to using the measurements.
And that's again really being in fact kids, they do a lot of it in elementary school and they take a lot of time, but it doesn't seem to stick. Because I think you experienced that in college. I also experienced that in high school. I think all of us did. And I just, one time I had my kids measure things in a room and pull by the nearest quarter of an inch. And I just walked out in the hallway and said, if I ever do that, just take me out and shoot me. They can't find a quarter of an inch on a ruler.
Right.
So,
well, the teacher had students, well, I guess one in particular, I had measured and said, can't measure the nearest eighth, which
right.
was 1 and 51/8. Took it to my dean and said, well, what's wrong with her answer? It was 1 inch and 51/8.
Right. So, and so I think that goes back to doing fewer things in elementary school grades and making sure they have a really, really good foundation and understanding.
I guess he's
where we are. So do we need to get back on task with talking about what you guys want?
What else we got?
Yeah, so what are some other things?
One more that we were curious about, percents, what you all are doing with percents at sixth grade.
Look. We are keeping them with ratio and proportion.
Makes sense.
Is that what you wanted to know?
Or how in depth of what we're going?
Let's see.
Where are you starting with them?
I'm sorry?
Where are you starting with them?
What would be the first thing about the percent?
Julie Andrew said, let's start at
very
deep.
This is not fair.
We think that they will come to us with knowledge of having explored denominators of
oh, yeah. Yeah.
And so you may not have called them percents, but we just continue with that. And so if we have a denominator of 100 and then we explain to them that we call that percent, and we start there and then we start building ratios and then the proportions, and where we are figuring out how much something is of 100 in the sixth grade, we will keep with the whole number unit rates and whole number parts in the proportion, and will not introduce the fractions, which could be complex fractions, until seventh grade. I'm not sure if I'm answering you. And then I can bring in my circle graphs.
Right. Well, if you look under our positive fractions, number and operation of positive fractions, we have a 1 and a 2. And under our 1, it's understanding the relationship between fractions, decimals, and percents. So we're adding in the percents there. But we are saying limited to denominators with factors of 100. So we did kind of specify that.
Why would you say factors of 100? You're talking about 10
fourths.
In the comparison, so that they could find an equivalency. So, in other words, they would have to take
they
and find
three
an equivalent fraction that 1/4 is the same thing as 25 over 100.
But then the parts of the whole expressed as fractions, decimals, percents, given a value less than 1, express the equivalency.
Can you explain that a little further?
Given a value less than 1, be able to express its equivalency as a fraction. If my kids were given 3/5, I need to know what that is as a decimal.
But why is
we're talking conversion.
We didn't do mixed numbers.
Be able to do that.
So we were limiting that percent, which then, to me, it's not the full, like the whole idea of percent.
I agree with you. And so I personally wouldn't do it if I were you, but I'm not you. I would keep it in sixth grade so that they can focus on what percent is and go to the full extent with
it can be over 100 and under 100.
Yeah.
So just delete it is what you're suggesting.
I think what we're trying to do is relate to fractions and decimals and recognizing that the numbers can be expressed in all these different ways. I think that was the basic thing, is recognizing that a fraction of something can be expressed as a fraction, decimal, percent.
I agree with doing the fraction to a decimal, and I agree with they should be doing those base 10, I'm going to call them, even though you doesn't like that type of thing. No, don't come in. However, the percent part, I'm not sure why a fifth grader means. I think when you bring it in sixth grade, that then you can fully develop it. And you can take it with the ratios, and you can take it on to the fractions, which they have a solid foundation for, and you build them solidly with 100 as a denominator. It's one of the possible denominators that we have. And so we just say that there is a special name when we relate that to 100, and that is percent. And you may have seen percents on your papers, and you can just develop it more fully when it's cohesive like that.
But don't we want to make sure we avoid Julie's problem of them thinking that the denominator is always 100? Or you said that we always divide by 5.
They're not always 100 for them. Yeah, it's just one of them.
No, but that you said, because they have limited to denominators, well, factors of 100.
Fifth, tenth, so that they were.
But at some point, maybe, because I like what you said earlier, Nancy, when you're talking about, we're not going to do complex numbers, but we're going to explain to you that these other numbers exist. So as long as they explain that we're going to be limited to factors of 100, but this would apply beyond that.
Well, I think when they use fractions in other things, they were just talking about limiting it to factors of 100 when they were dealing
Change it. For change in percent. But when they're dealing with fractions and others, I think that they mean, and I would hope that they would have other fractions as well. So that isn't very clear with that. I think that, I mean, I think you do need to wait, but I do kind of like the percent as part of the ratio.
They understand.
Introduced as part of the ratio discussion.
Well, and if with the measurement piece that's in the geometry part, you know, that's going to involve, and I think if, I'm not sure about the wording on your number four there, and I may be looking at the wrong document. My number four, it says convert like measurement units within a given measurement system.
That's right.
Okay. So, I'm not sure what there would be to convert if they're in the same measurement system and they're like units.
They have so many metric feet.
They have so many feet, they could tell you how many inches that one is, or whatever.
So you don't, you mean convert measurement units within it. There, they would not be like measurement. There would be
convert measurement. I don't like in the same system.
Yeah, you must be on that.
Okay, it's an old copy. So that would involve some of what you're talking about with the ratios, you know, especially if they were in images or, you know,
for the
I mean, if there was an activity that involved, you know, distance, area, length, area, volume, that kind of thing, they, there would need to be some conversions happening.
Is that the middle school, like, the ratio? I don't think this says area, it just says capacity length.
Well, earlier we said third grade was perimeter, fourth grade was area, fifth grade was volume. So all along the way, if they are doing anything that involves measurement, whether it be metric or standard, there's going to be issues where they have to use, you know, the fraction one. I mean, that's going to be, like, embedded throughout the whole thing.
Not necessarily. It could be. It doesn't have to be.
Because it looked like you guys highlighted specific things that you wanted to, us to look at, and that was
or that we were
whether or not
sure about, or we knew
new
wording here.
And I think I find myself too getting up on other things. But I think that multiplying fractions, including mixed numbers, is good where it's at. And we had talked about how we would like to see them have a pretty good understanding and, you know, just a really solid foundation of that before they come to sixth grade. I mean, was it dividing fractions? Is that what we said we were doing in the sixth grade? But the rest of that, definitely, I think. And solving problems, contextual. We've talked all about contextual and application and things like that, and it would be very good for that to happen.
Yeah, so when reasonable. Anything we can put into a context for kids, because a lot of times we have a lot of people, they can maybe perform the operation, but they have no idea what it means, and when it's in context, and sometimes it has a lot more meaning for them, especially when you're talking about, I think, the vision that we're dividing by fractions. So put that in some kind of context. Modeling, putting it in context. Because the operations, I mean, the skill sets are critical that they be able to do. However, we have a lot of people that are teaching rules and have taught rules for years, and just teaching rules doesn't stick. So they have to be able to teach it in terms of a context for kids to understand and model. So rules alone are the most forgettable things that kids can do without applying to some form of context. So where reasonable, whatever we can put in a context really helps kids understand.
So your rule is to put in the context?
Well, There you go.
Did you move comparing fractions from fourth grade to fifth grade, or is this just with other denominators?
We have not done fourth grade, but we tried to set fifth grade so that we could have this conversation, and now we've started back at kindergarten. So we realize in fraction that after we set third, and in measurement, after we set the third grade standards, that'll have an impact on fourth grade, which means the fifth grade might change some more. So we just kind of put down at fifth grade what we thought would be the best to have this conversation. And kind of what our end point, and then we'll start with the, start at kindergarten and try to build up. That's the idea. You've started with your middle school, so you've got your middle school kind of situation.
Yeah, we wanted to get that done because we thought that was the block between the two.
Between the two.
Right.
So Margaret, are you suggesting that really that might be a fourth grade standard, what we have is fifth grade?
Some comparison maybe at fourth grade.
Okay.
We also added the word ordering, which kind of takes it on, and that's what I'm thinking with it as well.
And there's a lot of repetition between fourth and fifth. Mm-hmm. Because I think the whole idea is to get a lot of that well into their minds. So I can understand why they're confused.
I just like to go back and ask just general questions on number one, on the very first thing. So my question is, I don't understand the yellow part. I need help. That's not a question, it's a statement. I need help.
Yeah, and I think that was
Number one on relationships and algebraic thinking.
Well, don't use that table as the example to go with that because those numbers don't make sense to that. That's just what that table would look like. Show my email.
As an input output. So generate and compare two multiple patterns using two given rules and a common starting point.
So
is the standard.
One of them adds three and one of them adds five. One of them adds three and one of them multiplies by two.
Two, and they have to come up with the pattern as they go down.
Right.
So they shouldn't always have to add, keep adding as they go. They should be able to do the add three, do the add two, but then as they go, there's a pattern as they go, and they should be able to plot those points on a graph from that common point.
Which is the second bullet. We separated the original standard into two statements.
It's a rough draft. In rough draft, anything goes, because I always tell my kids spelling does not count in rough draft.
When we put this whole thing together, we need to be cohesive in our language case. We're still 12, so we're going to get together. It needs to be really
good. What's the rough?
We're really rough.
I'm trying to find the original.
It's on fifth grade. Grade mathematics.
So this is setting up for those initial operations.
We have some
starting those relationships. We have an order that we're comparing.
What was the bandwidth and issue?
Oh, okay.
The age issue. I mean, it's just the overarching problem.
His issue with
I don't think at this level that the students are expected to it does say represent. I don't know if they're just going to continue a pattern that they're observing or if they're expected to represent something later on with a formula.
So they're not looking for the pattern, they're generating.
They're generating.
Right.
So
it's not
some are filled in.
See three numbers, what's the next one? It's not that, which is what you've been talking about. Right.
So in this
Well, you talked about see three numbers, what's the pattern? You can't tell from three numbers, you can't tell from 10 numbers.
Right.
That's not what they're doing. They're talking about giving a input output rule, generate numbers. So there, that, this has a set.
And then for the graph, they're going to be just using the XY coordinate plane and have input, output.
Yeah.
I think that would be beautiful,
yeah.
especially for sciences. Yeah. You know, that would be.
Yeah, that's what they're talking about.
I think yes, that's what they're talking about.
So maybe they talk about independent variables and Z.
Well, I don't think so at this point. No.
I think it's sixth grade.
I will give another picture from that.
Yeah, we did that.
And independent, we had this discussion talking to science about when is independent, dependent variables introduced in science so that. We had talked about that
with middle
school. Right now, yes. Sixth grade, but we don't know if there are changes being made as to when that's going to be because we need to be.
Independent, dependent variable, that's going to hit, for science, it's going to hit fifth grade. That's a heavily tested area, so they know that in fifth grade.
Well, and that's correct. As soon as you transfer to the graph,
right now, that's my kids are learning.
I agree. You may have generated the patterns independently, but when you relate them by graphing them together, then you're saying that there's an independent and a dependent variable.
We just didn't use that vocabulary in our sense, so to say.
Yeah. And I think that vocabulary for elementary teachers, they teach usually both math and science most of the time, and so I think that language probably that probably comes automatically because they'll be talking about their science classes, and they'll hopefully be relating those two concepts together. I would hope.
Is it insulting to literally write it in standard note to make sure they're being consistent in the two subjects?
I think that we do need to somehow address that, but make sure that we're. That science is not asking them to do things before math expects them to do things, just because that's
it makes sense.
And also sometimes you have things not taught the way that maybe they're just given things rather than teaching the mathematical approach, and the kids don't understand that. So
it wouldn't be that hard if we need to make put in fifth grade for them to use that language, but that's not the way we have it now.
Right. But if in fifth grade science they're going to use the word independent and dependent variable, then we might think about that for fifth grade math as well to make sure that.
I think that's just another thing that we let science know, like we talked about before, Kathy.
I agree. Scientific notations.
This is where it's appropriate for us because we're using variables at that point.
Right.
Up through fifth grade, we're using numerical expressions.
Yes.
And when we start using variable expressions in sixth grade, that's when we will introduce. Independent and dependent, and it has to do with the representation, not because we're trying to deny poor fifth grade science teachers something else too.
Yes. Did you say that you have not yet made contact with the science group?
Correct.
I have a connection on the K-5 science group, so maybe you can.
Okay.
Well, because that generated the idea about volume. Volume is big in fifth grade, so we would want science to recognize that we are keeping volume in fifth grade.
And they're going to want to
get
it down
there,
too.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Volume of
the representation with whole numbers in that.
I mean, that's what it says in here. I think it's such a whole number.
Yeah.
That was standard.
Our standards are going to be good.
Yeah.
Well, science has to comply.
Do the French thing. I wasn't trying to be snot.
No, I just didn't want to shake my head yes without really looking. I could have just appeased you, but I was like, oh, I need to get it.
Anything else? My dears. Messieurs.
Was there another one besides the first one that you had? Okay. So it does help when we highlight the ones that we
can just well, I think it does. And part of that is if we would know anything that you want us to look at, give feedback on, and if you would do that in a consistent way.
We've decided today we're going to highlight in orange in honor of October.
No!
So if there's no other discussion, then should we all break from, is there any other discussion that you might have? Any answer, you think, any questions?
Did we need to talk about, we had a big discussion just about the structure and the layout of the standards, of, you know, the sort of broad heading and then the, you know, where, what's exactly the standard? I mean, do we need to talk about the structure of the standards?
We had that discussion too, and of course ours is a little different from yours because when we get to high school we have courses.
Right.
So We're not, we don't have answers on that.
We do like the idea of having those, what are called domains.
Yes.
And then having them clustered so teachers can kind of look at them, but we haven't worked out the exact wording, so we're not down to the bare, you know, brass tacks yet. But I do like the structure overall that I saw you guys have. Once again, I didn't agree with data and statistics, but that's your choice, you know? But I did like that you had large groups like that, having names. I like the overall structure.
And with respect to Nancy's comment about my issue with 8-10, I'm fine with 8-10, the decimal system, and that is fine, but I just, when I looked at it, and something we were looking at, you know, you had base 10, and then you had a completely separate section about fractions, and to me, the implication is that fractions are not base 10, which I think is false. So, that was, I mean, I would write the headings the way that makes sense to you, and, you know, and then that is what we intend to do, and I think that will work.
Julie was a lawyer in a former life, so just takes on this for that. And you know, of course.
And Beverly's going to sit with her.
So where or will the mathematical practices be incorporated?
Oh, they'll be in there.
Yes. We've all had conversations, yes. And I think as a work group, we've all thought that they were very important to have. We just don't know, like California kind of has it built in with each one, and then, you know, some of them have it in the front, some of them have it in the back, and we just don't know yet how.
And we do like the overall focal point type ideas at the beginning of the grade levels.
Like an overview at the beginning of the grade
level. Okay,
yeah, we hadn't discussed.
Because I think Tiffany is the one that said that helps her so much as a teacher to see that one page overview.
Oh,
yeah. To
yeah.
see
the big ideas.
The big ideas for that.
Yeah.
So they know.
Areas too.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because that.
Well, that's just idea. Our little cluster headings pulled right. over and then a right. paragraph of.
Yeah. Because we talked about that. We haven't talked about that for the high school courses yet, but those, you know, that's for them to see a one page glance.
So, right. like for an algebra course, would you put the math practices in their own?
They'll probably be in their own little box.
Okay.
To corral one.
Yeah.
What are you all looking at for math practices?
I'm sorry? We haven't, I don't know, we've had a real team discussion about the math. I think that we had the first day talking about things that are important in math. We talked about it in little individual groups, and we all came up with ideas that we didn't specifically state the mathematical practices, but all really are involved in the mathematical practices.
Both of our documents, standards documents, we're using have something similar to that.
Well, and also right. started with the curriculum alignment.
Right.
The initiative, right. There's a page in there.
It feels like that should be consistent K-12.
And I think that's the one thing we'll have to come and sit down together is, okay, what are they or how are we going to word that so that we're consistent in what we do? Because I agree.
We should need some of our basic.
No.
One of the things we've talked about in our group is sort of like the overarching principle. As you read through like the Common Core standards, it'll say that they solve the problems in word problems, or they solve it in real situations or whatever. And our overarching principle has been they should do that on all things. Like, we shouldn't have to specifically say that everywhere. So in the upfront part somewhere, we say that these expectations are that they're able to do it, you know, in isolation and applied to real world situations or whatever. And so, because it seemed like it was restated over and over again, and so our principle's just been operating in the mindset that they're going to need to do this in applied situations.
And we have varying levels of that. For instance, and when there are skills that are used both in Algebra 1 and Algebra 2, and we're talking about linear, quadratic, and exponential functions. We want the skill built with how to manipulate, how to work with exponents, how to combine terms, etc. We want that solidly in place in Algebra 1, with maybe some context, but we want Algebra 2 to be the focal point of modeling those things. So we will have the same thing when we go through middle school as well. There are times when you introduce it and you get the skill down and you lead up to a context.
I think we need to be careful about how much we just kind of say, oh, and use this, remember to use this everywhere, because as a teacher, when we're busy and we're looking through what we need to teach, it's easy to not pay as much attention to the front of it, the front of the document or whatever, because I'm focused on the grade level. And I don't always go back every time that I'm looking at a standard to say, oh, do I need to apply this one? Do I not need to apply that one? And there are some that I think is more important to put in context than others, probably. And so I would say on those, it probably would be beneficial to have at least a good message.
Yeah, I agree with that. I just wanted to make a plug for that. You know, keeping this, and I hesitate to call it a linear flow, but something that you can just, you know, where a teacher can just look at it and see. And so I don't like the idea of having this sort of, you know, completely separate thing that, oh, by the way, you got to check that too, because I feel like then you're turning back and forth and doing all that. But, I mean, that is an issue. We have not addressed that in our work very much.
We talked about the philosophy of, I've already said we talked about less is more per grade level, but we've also talked about within a standard more is better. In other words, we would like to make sure students, teachers completely understand without having to like go to the progressions or some other document to figure out what we're talking about. We would like to make it as clear as possible in the standard. So,
as opposed to very fun, when it comes to like number and operations, you can say that you want these computations and the applications of, you're just a little, you're repeating it like the grade level or whatever it is appropriate, as opposed to just only in the front, which is right when you say grade 4 number operations.
Just something real quick that crossed my mind with circle graphs in sixth grade. What prereq skills would they need, if any, from fifth grade, like using a compass or a protractor or
measure angle measures. They didn't do it. It's like their fourth grade. Okay, so they've used protractor. Well, and we haven't done those standards yet, but currently it's introduced in those grade levels. Okay. So like reference to the circle is like the fourth grade standard. The angles. Yes. Currently, the angle is measured in reference to a circle with its center of
the 1 out of 3. Was it staying in yours?
We haven't done fourth grade, but we'll have to have some measurements there. So we'll make a note that that's going to be important.
Yeah. Anything else we're going to do? Do you guys have anything else, Mara? Or did we get your questions? Cleared up or muddied or?
I think that was all the content related.
Okay, I'm still like not clear on the percent, but we'll have a discussion in our work group.
We're going to go in depth in sixth grade. We're going to start in week. I believe, and this is the discussion we had, but we follow, that is where we are going to have them relate those fractions to decimals.
So that equivalency will be a standard within your sixth grade.
Yes, and so we understood that element number 5 would have the idea of equivalent fractions, of equivalent quantities.
Right,
strong equivalency.
Yes, strong equivalency. So taking different forms, but developing the percent, we saw as a sixth grade concept.
Okay.
So, I guess it's 12 o'clock. Are we ready to go to lunch?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. So, there's going to be quite a few people in there at lunch. So, between what time do we want to be back from lunch? Okay. Elementary school, you've got paper, you can go whenever you want.
So,
we
will
go upstairs.
That was the answer.
Let's be back in here working at 12:45.
I'd say 12:45.
All right, we can get that. 12:45.
Nope.